Welcome back to another edition of the Rodcast. Oh, it is a beautiful hump day edition of the Rodcast. We actually have football to discuss on the show. We have some audio from Steve Sarkisian, the head coach of Texas football, discussing the first day of spring practice. Thanks to my man Patrick. We have tons of audio. We'll break it all down. We'll hear from Steve Sarkisian here in the first segment. But all throughout the show, we do know exactly who the Texas men's basketball team. We know now who they are playing after the first four matchup between Colorado State and Virginia. And that was an ugly game if you decided to watch it. But thankfully, we have my man Patrick, who watches a lot of ball. He's going to break down that matchup between Texas and Colorado State. We'll talk about that, their first game in the NCAA tournament. We'll also get into some NFL news, notes and nuggets, Cowboys free agency. The cricket's there, but there are some storylines that we need to address. We'll discuss that. So we'll get into the latest mock drafts. Mel Kiper has his latest mock draft. Daniel Jeremiah has his latest mock drafts. We'll talk about what the Longhorns are. We'll also talk about what the Cowboys are expected to do in those mock drafts. Remember, the Texans traded out of the first round, so pretty much they're done in the mock season. So we'll talk about the Cowboys a little bit coming up a little bit later on the show. We do have a Raj rant. I have some advice for Quinn Ewers there. We'll go behind the burnt orange curtain. Pretty much the entire show will be behind the burnt orange curtain. So that's the way that works. But also, we have At the Turn coming up at 8:30. We'll talk a little golf there. Also, we got my man Nick Shuley coming up with Setlist ATX coming up a little bit later on at 9 o'clock. So we are jam-packed. Let's not waste any time. Let's introduce you to the rest of the crew. He's the real MVP, one of the hardest working members of the ARN family. He's got a hustler spirit, period. I don't know what he's paid. I'm pretty damn sure that he's underpaid. Ain't no 401k for a hustle, and he is a hustle man of many talents. He is my friend, neighbor, and co-host. It's Patrick Davis, y'all. What's going on, brother?
Oh, it's a good Wednesday morning, and watching that first half of the game last night of Colorado State and Virginia, I was like, wow. Yeah, I'd rather play Virginia. I don't think it's going to happen, but man, when they scored 14 points in the first half, I thought, that's the team I want to play right there, a team that put up 14 and a half. That's who I want to play.
That was UGLY, man. You talked about how Virginia is notorious for bad offense. Ooh. That was horrible.
Yeah,
that was terrible, as Charles Barkley. That was bad. Yeah, I mean, I think we all wish Texas could have played Virginia. Now, like, damn, that was the matchup. And we were debating what was the more favorable matchup for Texas. Well, if you chose Virginia as the more favorable matchup, then you were right. There you go. I remember, and Patrick, I think you were saying that Colorado State presented more problems.
In your opinion, because Virginia is the type of team that can put up 14 points and a half.
So I think you were right on that one. I think we all, I mean, now I'm like, damn, why couldn't Virginia just have a great night that night and then do what they know? Because for Virginia fans on social media, this is what they do. This is actually what they do all the time. This is the type of basketball they play. And man, that is basically first team to 60 was going to win, but it was ugly in the first half. You knew watching early on, like, oh, they got no shot to win this game. They ain't going to win this game.
No,
unless they just transform from a caterpillar to a butterfly. From the first half to the second half, then they got no shot. And, they
wouldn't win. It was bad. Let me introduce you real quick, and then we'll get into more of it. Yeah. My co-host is a proud alumni of DBU. He's got more papers than Dunder Mifflin and watches more film than Siskel and Ebert. He is the new Rod Father of Austin Sports Radio, Mr. Rod Babers.
I appreciate that intro. And, yeah, we'll get into Texas basketball, the men's basketball preview a little bit later on. We'll do that in the top of the 7 o'clock hour. We'll do that and break it down. Let my man Patrick have the floor for you because I know he's actually been watching both these teams and watches more basketball than anybody I know. We'll also get – that's when we'll talk Cowboys, too. After that, we'll cram into Cowboys free agency updates. If we have time, Mel Kiper and Darren Jeremiah mock draft. If not, we'll hit it up on the other side. We'll also hear from Steve Sarkisian. We'll start off the show talking about Texas spring football, give you some of the storylines, some of the news, notes, and nuggets coming out of the first day of spring practice. It is Overreaction Wednesday, essentially, because we're going to overreact to everybody being in shells, what's Sark cost underwear, and they didn't really even do anything. There was a 40-minute window for the media to watch practice, which is a lot longer than it usually is. I mean, from what I hear, Patrick, that's double the amount of time. Usually it's like 20-minute or 15-minute window, and they're like, all right, y'all get out of here. Get out of here. Y'all got y'all pictures. Y'all know what the hell y'all watching anyway, so get out of here. They gave him a 40-minute window. So either he's trying to buy goodwill with the media R. Sark is really confident showcasing his team. He's like, nah, man, we look damn good. I want everybody to see how good we look.
Yeah.
I think we look good.
Yeah, I think that was the enjoy it now. Here's 40 minutes a day. I'm taking this time back the rest of the season. Because once we get into it and I start teaching them things, I don't want you here anymore. But yeah, right now,
for a damn thing.
You know, when we show up first day, you can come in and watch them warm up for 40 minutes and then you got to go.
I think you might be right about that. We'll see how the rest of the season goes. But everybody's feeling good. The media feels good because they got plenty of content, storylines to talk about because they got such a good look at the team. I think Sark is feeling good, too, about his team. He actually was really complimentary of the first practice. So we'll hear from Sark. He talked about a lot of different things. My man Patrick broke down the audio. Speaking of Patrick, he'll have the big fat poll of the day coming up for you at 6:45. You don't want to miss that. Also, we got the Horn headlines that'll be coming up here momentarily that'll get you informed and updated, educated on all the big headlines of the day. If you want to sign up for our bracket, you can go to hornfm.com and you can sign up for the Horn bracket.
Yes.
I'll remind folks of that.
Yes.
Correct?
Go. Yes.
I've not done it yet. I'm going to do it tonight. I was waiting on
I've
the matchup.
Some people are in there. I've not finalized my bracket either. I threw one together when we were setting things up. So I'm in the bracket, but that's not my final bracket yet. I have to go and adjust.
You just did it to reserve a spot.
I put it in there, but we'll see. We're going to adjust some things in there. Right now, Texas is my champion, and I don't know if that's going to stand. But
wow!
I don't know if I'm going full Bijan on this, where Bijan posted his bracket where he's got Texas winning it all. Don't know.
Did he really?
Yes. So I don't know if we're going to stick to that. Hey. But
that's why he's a legendary lifetime Longhorn right there. But homerism is deep.
Yes. Yeah, so I'll put it together probably tonight. I was going to do it last night, and then got caught up doing other things. So. We'll get it done tonight. But yeah, that if you go to hornfm.com, it'll say Bracket Mania. You click on that and it'll take you to our pool that you can join and go against us. And Ty will be in there and Rod and myself. And we'll see who else at the Horn wants to throw a name in there. And we'll have a good old time. And you can it's really the bracket every year is the one that's the most humbling when somebody's winning. And then you go talk to them about why they picked it. And they're like, I just felt that. It's like, have you watched anything like any college basketball this season? They're like, well, it was on one day.
Yeah. The truth is, I mean, only a few people are watching college basketball all season long. There's not a lot of people that are watching a lot of college basketball. They're probably watching their team. They're not watching a lot of college basketball just as a whole. And that's why I think the paralysis by analysis applies here. You can do research and almost just do too much damn research. Somebody comes in and be like, nah, I did it off the gut. Nah, I picked it off of colors. Nah, I did it off of mascots. And they'll come in there and they really got just as good a chance as you in picking some of these matchups just because March Madness is just that.
Yeah, and then like it's all the people at the zoo or whatever, aquarium, get animals to pick the winners.
Exactly. And the turtle picks.
I think there was an octopus that picked the World Cup winner for like the last 10 years or something.
Come on, man. Now, there might be something to that, but I'm telling you, the bracket, we know, man, that is, it's just mostly luck, pretty much. But it is fun to dive into the data. I like that. I actually like all the stats and the trends and the patterns. I think that's pretty cool. So we'll dive into that. We'll talk Texas versus Colorado State. We'll also, like I said, we'll get into some of the other NFL news notes and nuggets too. But let's start with the Horn headlines. Let my man Patrick get you informed, educated with the top stories of the day. Then we'll come back. We'll dive into some Texas spring football discussion. Hit us with those Horn headlines, Patrick.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball rallied late and walked off the game in 10 innings against Air Force last night. Jalen Flores hit a two-run home run in the ninth to tie the game, and then D. Kennedy hit a shot to center field with the bases loaded in the 10th to win the game 6-5. Texas will have a quick turnaround as they face Air Force again this afternoon at 4. Two more teams earned their ticket to the Field of 64 in the NCAA men's tournament last night as Wagner withstood a late run by Howard to advance, and Colorado State had no problem with Virginia winning 67-42. The Rams held Virginia to just 25% shooting on the game and will now focus their attention on the Texas Longhorns, who they will face on Thursday. In the NBA, the Rockets kept their playing hopes alive with a 137-114 win over the Wizards, led by Jalen Green with 42 points. Houston now sits just 2.5 games back of the 10 seed. And the two other Texas teams were in action against each other on Tuesday as the Mavericks held on to beat the Spurs 113-107 behind Kyrie Irving's 28 points and another triple-double from Luka Doncic. And that is your Horn headlines.
All right, let's thank you, Patrick, for the horn headlines. We appreciate that. Remember, the text line is open for you as well, 512-447-3776. That'll be handy for you when we get to the big fat poll of the day coming up at 6:45. But let's talk Texas spring football. So many storylines, so many different ways we could go. I say we start with Sark and his comments, and then we can react to those. Could you pull up cut two, please, Patrick? And this is Sark basically talking about, you know, his reaction to practice. And how the team looked, first impressions, if you will, on the first day of practice of spring ball. Here is Steve Sarkisian, the head coach of Texas football.
For us, this was a pretty good first day. You know, and I'm always hesitant to lay too much praise after one practice. Like, I'm always a little hesitant to be too critical after one practice. But I thought that it was pretty evident that the energy was really good out there at practice. It was pretty evident the amount of depth that we have. I mean, this is the most numbers that we've had in a spring practice since we've been here. And, I think that's a combination of a few things. I think the transfer portal has affected that, where you can have guys, you know, kind of replace players right away. I think that's a byproduct of so many early admits, guys coming mid-year. And in the end, you know, the fact that we were able to two spot all of our team stuff in practice, and that we were able to go ones, twos, threes, and fours, and everybody on the team getting reps and improving and getting better. I thought the coaches really, you know, demanding the fundamentals, the techniques that are needed in all three phases, offense, defense, and special teams, was evident as well today. But again, there's a ton of things that we need to get better at and we need to work on. But for a first day spring practice, I was definitely pleased.
All right. Let's start talking about his first impressions of spring ball. Yeah, they are really deep just because they have 13 early enrollees, from this latest recruiting class. Then the 7 transfer portal, guys, you add that. And then there's 5 summer enrollees. Like the guys from not just from early enrollees, but summer enrollees who came in too. So essentially, you're talking about 25 new additions to the team. Some who 5 who came during the summer, 13 who are not early enrollees for the spring, and your transfer portal additions. So that yeah, they probably are as deep as they've ever been. They've had a lot of talent. Last year's team was really talented too. I mean, that was a talented group, but they probably just weren't as deep because they didn't have all those additions. I mean, this is as many early enrollees, new additions in the spring as Texas has ever had. Maybe this is going to be a new trend, but they've never had this many new additions already on the team. And these are all the guys that Sark's recruiting. And he's recruiting what? He's recruiting things that he can't coach. Speed and size. Big humans. Yeah. And speed. So, of course, now that he's stacked, 4 or 5 recruiting classes now, and these guys are coming in early, and you got the transfer portal, the team just looks different, because I don't know if it had this look last year, because it seems like almost every position now has been overhauled, and it's got almost all Sark guys. I mean, in terms of guys he recruited, guys he brought in,
yeah,
his body types, his skill sets that he wants, yeah, he covets.
Yeah, and I think he's finally getting to the point where he has depth that he can trust, where, you know, in those first couple of years, it was a lot of guys that weren't necessarily his. He was still feeling out the, you know, who was all in and who was bought in and who wasn't, yeah, in that first couple of years. And by year 3 last year, he was there, but he didn't necessarily have the players because he kind of weeded out everybody else he wasn't sure about. Now he feels pretty good about that. You say that, the additions that you bring in, plus just another year of guys coming in, of sophomores that redshirt freshmen who have already been there, who know where they're supposed to be and what they're doing. It feels like he's finally got his team ready to go for this season. And it must feel good to walk into spring training and see everybody and go, okay, I know who everybody is and I want everybody here, versus what it probably was a couple years ago of, you know, hoping that everybody was going to buy in. You feel a lot better about it now.
Yeah, no question. And one of the groups that seemed to be getting a lot of praise was the wide receiving group from members of the media in terms of how they looked and how many great athletes they had there. Here's Sark talking about that wide receiving group. We'll come back and discuss it. But here's Steve Sarkisian talking about the wide receivers that he brought in, that new group, and really now the chemistry and connection that they got to build with their quarterback. Here's Steve Sarkisian.
Well, one thing for me is, are we being coachable, right? And, you know, you guys were out there, I think, for some of our, you know, routes on air type stuff. And, you know, the details in those routes of the landmarks on where the receivers are supposed to be, the timing of those throws, because that's how you develop trust. And then that subtle communication between a quarterback and receiver that will grow over time as we continue to move through it. But again, I'm just looking for guys that can do what we're asking of them, do it to the best of their ability, because we're a very talented group, but doing it to the best of their ability. And then the quarterback's trusting those guys that they're going to be where they're supposed to be. And so that's going to be a bit of a process as we go. But like I said, today was a good start to it. I thought there were some high level plays that got made. Again, I think there were some things that we're going to have to go and correct off this tape. As we grow, hopefully the rapport with Quinn and Arch and those guys continues to move in a positive direction as we go throughout spring.
Yeah, shout out to my man, CJ Vogel, who was one of the members over there on Texas Football, who was there at practice. And he actually published a piece over at OnTexasFootball.com that actually has the first group that went out there, the group that went out first. And it was Isaiah Bond. In terms of wide receivers,
yeah.
Isaiah Bond, Jonte Cook, and DeAndre Moore.
Okay.
Exactly. If DeAndre Moore actually, and I've heard that he may be the most efficient route runner on the team in terms of the guy being efficient, getting in and out of his breaks, running precise routes, we know the young Ryan Wingo is going to get sprinkled in because he's a prodigy and a feeder.
Yeah.
And then you assume that, you know, Isaiah Bond, Jonte Cook, that's your top two. You throw in a Matthew Golden, who looked fantastic out there. That's a guy that maybe we're sleeping on a little bit in terms of what he can add to the offense. You add in a Matthew Golden. If DeAndre Moore actually is going to be a part of it too, my theory, at least my prediction, that Sark will expand his wide receiver rotation.
Yeah.
I think maybe it's on track to actually come to fruition. I right now, I think he may be at five guys potentially that can help him. We have not had Texas have that many guys in regular rotation at the receiver position since Sark has been there.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we'll see early on, you know, Sark is a big trust guy, and so it is going to depend on who he can trust. So I think we'll see definitely early in that non-conference, you know, even against Michigan to an extent, we'll see guys get in that maybe, you know, you get a bigger rotation and it'll probably – shorten up by the end of the season a little bit more, and you'll see the top guys play a few more snaps because those are the guys he'll trust to make the catches. He'll trust them to block. He'll trust them to do everything and be in the right place at the right time. I think there's also, you should point out for DeAndre Moore, Isaiah Bond, you're going to have to put in that first group. Like, you're not going to not put him in. But as for Matthew Golden and Silas Bolden and some of those guys, you have to throw in that this is their first time doing the spring training with Texas. So they may be throwing DeAndre Moore, who knows what the drills are going to be a little bit more, who knows where to be and what to do just a little bit more than some of the other guys who may be asking more questions. They can watch first and then learn. So as spring training goes on, you see if he holds on to that place, DeAndre Moore does. And if he does, you know, this is one of those chances that all you ask for as a player is a chance to prove it. And so if he's getting his chance to prove it right now, then go take advantage of that and don't ever let them pull you out of that lineup.
Yeah, but from what I hear, it is the coaches really like DeAndre Moore.
I can believe. I'm not saying that.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I think what you point out is a factor, but they think he's really, really talented, and they believe it's going to be a hell of a competition at that wide receiver position to get him off the field and to take reps away from him. And I think it's just going to push that room to be even better. I do think Matthew Golden's going to see the field. Silas Bolden's not even there yet, and I think he's going to end up seeing the field. At least he'll be your starting punt returner, I think, in that regard. But as a wide receiver, I don't know. I just think Sark's going to end up expanding like he did at Bama when he had a lot of good wide receivers. He expanded the rotation when he had four first-round guys. He does not have four first-round guys here, but he does have a really deep wide receiver group. And most people assume that Isaiah Bond's going to be wide receiver one. He looked really, really good. But players talk a lot about Jonte Cook. Now, they don't know Isaiah Bond that well. I'm sure that they know of him or maybe know him through some other circles, but he wasn't a teammate of theirs. But Jonte Cook does have an advantage in terms of if he's going to be the guy who gets the main target shares and is wide receiver one. He does have chemistry already with the quarterback. He does know the system already really well. And the players were at the combine, actually. They were really complimentary of Jonte Cook. Here's Sark when Sark was asked about Jonte Cook and his progress in the wide receiver room.
Yeah, no, I think again, player development is something that, you know, we take a lot of pride in our program, on and off the field. And, you know, I think one of the challenges is when we first got here, you know, I think JT might have been the only five-star in that class, you know, that was, you know, a top 20, 25 player in the country, according to you guys. hopefully, we're recruiting more high-quality players over time, and there's going to be more guys that are going to be in that developmental, you know, process early in their career. Jonte being one of those guys. You know, he had an opportunity last year to play behind possibly two first-round draft picks and another guy who's going to play in the NFL. And so how much do you attack that year to try to improve your game? I thought Jonte had a really good practice today from the naked eye without looking at the tape and kind of doing what he was asked of him, made plays when the ball came his way, had really positive energy out there on the field. But there's a lot of guys that are in that fold that hopefully they can continue to grow in the program as the years move forward.
All right, there you go, Sark, talking about the wide receiving group. We're talking about Jonte Cook. Of course, you know, I think it's interesting. Two things that are interesting about this media availability. First of all, that they got a 40-minute media window to watch practice, which is double what the media usually get. That's interesting. All right, what's Sark's motivation? Is he just confident, want to showcase his team, goodwill with the media, maybe all of the above? Of all the cuts we have, we're going to play a lot of Sark cuts throughout the show. And then, you know, I'll psychoanalyze what the coach is saying and, you know, pick up tidbits and then discuss, obviously, all the storylines coming out of spring. Out of all the cuts that we have, and Patrick broke all of them down, the Sark cuts from the media, I think it was like a 25-minute media.
Yeah, it's a little over 20 minutes, yeah.
Somewhere around there. Not one – I don't think there was one talking point or one question about the offensive line. Not one, really.
Not really.
Almost every other position gets addressed, but not O-line. I think it's telling. I think it says the media is there's really not. I mean, there is some mystery, I guess, you know, about the left guard position, but I just think you've been stockpiling talent there for so long. It's an assumed strength with Texas. I mean, I can't think of a time where Texas wasn't Texas fans and media, the anxiety of the fans, or at least the pessimism, concern from the fans was reflected in some questions that the media was asking. And it was about the O-line at one point, usually about quarterback too, but even QB. We're about to play a cut about Quinn Ewers, but that was, you know, just one question about quarterback. Hey, how's Quinn doing? He's all right. Good. How's,
yeah.
There you go. We actually have now the luxury of talking about the roster as a whole and not just focusing on these big holes in the roster, which at time was the offensive line or the quarterback instability or the quarterback drama, Texas being in quarterback hell or quarterback purgatory. You know, that those two major issues, by the way, don't exist. And we used to focus so much on them. I know this because I've been talking about it for 15 years, and you have too, Patrick. Isn't that interesting, though?
It is interesting that, and this was, I mean, basically he talked about two things in his opening, which was talking about the basketball teams and talking about the first day of practice. The rest was questions from the media. The media didn't ask him about the O-line. And so, you know, he's not going to bring it up himself and say,
no,
well, I didn't like any of it.
No, I think it's very telling.
Yeah, I think it's telling that they weren't looking at that. I think it's telling that there wasn't a bunch of questions about Arch Manning. I don't think there was a question about Arch Manning in there either.
I don't think it was.
I think they were happy with what they saw. They had a few questions about other things. But, yeah, neither one of those were brought up in there. But, yeah, the offensive line, the fact that you feel confident in it, that's something that Texas has not necessarily had for a long time. You know, and it's, you know, it's one of the reasons why they're trying to bring legislation about NIL is because the Pancake Factory worked.
It worked. Because think about it. Think about it. You're right about it working. How many have they lost via the transfer portal? They've been stockpiling them for like 3 years.
Yeah.
They've been stockpiling them. And by the way, remember they brought the entire offensive line back last year. I mean, 2 years ago. And then brought, and they're bringing back four of the five this year.
Yeah.
So they're bringing back guys who have already started on the O-line and stockpiling all of these elite O-linemen they're getting from around the country. And you start to think, say, none of them are transferring, and yet not a lot of them are playing right now. They, like I said, that means you're cooking up a bit of a beast in terms of the lines of scrimmage on the offensive side of the ball. And it allows you to develop those guys. Truly, when offensive line come in, they still have their teenage bodies. They, you know, their nutrition is probably terrible. They haven't been in a real strength and conditioning program. So you would like a year in an offseason to, you know, rebuild the frame and pack the right kind of pounds on them, teach them the right fundamentals so they don't have bad habits. But, you know, the transfer portal, you stockpile a lot of them and they want to leave. I just saw another big-time O-lineman hit the transfer portal. But it's interesting that they've been able to stockpile them and keep them here. And you're right, that's on culture. That's also on the NIL opportunity. So that's good.
Right. Happiness in the locker room, which the two ways of happiness is playing time and money are usually two of those big ones. And if they feel content, which, you know, they know, look, I'm taken care of. I don't necessarily need to, except, you know, if I go anywhere else, I'm risking that not getting any of it. And then also, there's no guaranteed playing time and wins anywhere in the country where you're going to walk in and be guaranteed to be able to compete at the highest level and play.
Agreed.
Because you can go play, but you may not win. And you may know win, but you may not play there either. So at a certain point, you know, if you feel happy being there, you're good with the coaching staff. You feel, you know, stability in the coaching staff. I think that's something that Sark can claim with these recruits now, the stability in the coaching staff to be able to walk in and say, go look at them. They've had three O-line coaches in the last 5 years. And look at them. They've been rotating guys because they're throwing guys under the bus. And they're not, you stay here, you know, you'll be family with us. We're all here together.
That used to be Texas.
And it did. But Sark has been.
Prior to Sark bringing in continuity, that used to be Texas. Rotating, you know, carousel, you know, revolving door of coaches. Anytime there was an issue, let's fire the coach. He has brought in a lot of stability. I'll give him a lot of credit for that. Before we get out of here, we would be remiss if we did not play a cut of Sark talking about the quarterback situation. Not a lot of questions about it. That's a good thing. Here is Sark talking about the development of Quinn and how Quinn looked day one of spring practice.
Yeah, I think Quinn looks good. You know, I mean, his body, we went from where he was a couple years ago to slimming himself all the way down last season to, if you look at him, he looks a little broader now this year. And I'm hopeful we can maybe get, you know, 3 to 5 more pounds of just strengthening him up that way. I thought Quinn played really confident today, you know, and had good command. And, you know, a little different for us, for Quinn and I this year, is my ability to talk to him through the mic. And we started practicing that today. And I think having 2 years of experience of working together and now having that dialogue through the headset, I think is going to be beneficial for us.
Yeah, actually, he went on in great detail about it. He was asked a lot of follow-up questions about the headset communication. We'll get into that, too. We'll play that audio because my man Patrick has that set up. We'll do that later on the show. As a matter of fact, we could get into it when we go behind the burn orange curtain, which we're going to do coming up next segment. So that's just the start of our spring football discussion. We'll continue it when we go behind the burn orange curtain coming up next. But later on the show, we'll also get to Texas men's basketball. We know who their opponent is going to be. It's going to be Colorado State. We'll break that down as well coming up a little bit later on. Go to hornfm.com if you want to sign up for our bracket challenge. You can do that at hornfm.com. Also, we got the big fat poll today coming up at 6:45, and you can get on the text line 512-447-3776 to keep up with the conversation. We'll come right back. More Texas football discussion. It is the big topic of the day, topic du jour. We'll come back and discuss it right here on the Rodcast with my man Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming back on the Horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time to go behind the burn orange curtain. A lot of the show is behind the burn orange curtain today. Talking a lot of Texas sports. Of course, you got Texas spring football now that has started. First day of spring practice yesterday. Sark met with the media. We're playing a lot of those cuts and reacting, overreacting, if you will, to Texas spring practice, at least the first day of it. Sark also he addressed a lot of different things. We haven't even gotten to the defense side of all these. I think he talked actually probably more about the defense than he actually did about the offense, but he talked about the new headset sideline communication that is going to happen. Well, it's actually not official yet, but everybody expects it to be something that is approved by the NCAA before the start of college football season after the sign stealing scandal at Michigan. So yes, Connor Stallions changed college football forever. I mean, he's got to, in the history books, they got to mention Connor Stallions because he's the reason now they have the headset communication, headset sideline communication. But Sark was asked about it. Matter of fact, he mentioned it in the last cut that we played on the previous segment. But he was asked to go into some detail about the new headset communication for the quarterbacks. And by the way, it's offense and defense. Don't forget about that. Offense and defense actually are going to have one player each that, just like the NFL, that wears, they'll have a, I think defense has a green dot. I don't know what the color is going to be for the offense, but they'll have the headset. The quarterback will have the headset communication. Some player on defense will, and it'll shut off at 15 seconds when 15 seconds are left on the play clock. So same rules that are in the NFL. So Sark was asked about this headset communication with Quinn and how they're getting used to it. They actually used it in the first spring practice. Here is Steve Sarkisian.
You know, I don't know if it's just Quinn. I think it's he and I, you know, because, again,
the headset specifically.
Yeah, no, it's just hearing it, you know, and as opposed to the signals. I mean, I still think he's going to look to the sideline, but yet hearing that call and then communicating that with the pertinent information that's needed. And I think the challenge for me is how much information is quality, good information, and when does it cross the threshold of too much to where it's a little bit of paralysis by analysis, you know, because there's too much information. And so, and that's a fine line of he and I working together with some of that stuff. He and I working with the offensive line and getting that communication done. But I thought it felt really comfortable for him today, first time out doing it.
Yeah, and he actually was asked about the approval of it because technically it has not yet been approved because the NCAA moves at like a glacier-like pace. But he was asked about that situation. Here's Sark giving clarification on how they're able to use it, even though it's not technically approved.
Yeah, we're in kind of that phase where they're allowing us that opportunity to do that. In working with the SEC and with the NCAA, that looks like it's going to be a go for us.
Can you play faster or slower because of the change?
I think you can do both, quite frankly. Okay. You know, again, that it's a lot easier to say five words and signal five words,
right,
but yet you can give more information and you can have some real dialogue to where you can speed up, slow down. And hopefully I can give him some information that allows him to play a little bit faster within plays as well.
And he also gave a little tidbit, and this is actually, you know, I think something a lot of teams are going to do, and I heard Kirby Smart talking about it too, that some teams are going to decide either to decline to even use the new headset communication, which is crazy, and stay with their old method of, you know, seeing it in signs or using, you know, poster boards or whatever I think they call them, play cards. But if Sark, he actually revealed that they're going to do both. They're going to use the headset, but also they're going to keep their signals too.
Well, I don't know if we're going to totally abandon that. Like I said, today was day one of working ourselves through it. And we're in total base install mode. We're not in a game plan mode. So we're still teaching the foundation of our offense, which is signaling. As we get closer to the season, start getting into training camp, I'm sure we're going to have different modes and mechanisms of getting play calls in. But again, we want to teach the foundation of signaling because God forbid the headset goes out in DKR for whatever reason, I still got to get the play into our players. And so we want to kind of have contingency plans available. So we still want to teach the foundation of our offense, which is signaling, but yet getting used to the new way of having the ability to communicate to the quarterback.
I like it. I mean, I think it's actually is going to help some guys learn it quicker because you'll have it. They'll be saying it, obviously, from a perspective, an auditory perspective, but you'll also have the visual perspective to it. I think it'll help some of the guys. Actually, everybody learns a little bit differently, and having two ways for something to be communicated to you or in multiple ways at the same time, it's definitely got to help it, you know, I think in terms of retention. For players,
yeah,
I think it'll actually help things.
Yeah, I mean,
and it goes so good.
And you talk about being able to speed up and slow down. If you are in a 2-minute drill or whatever else, and you don't want to huddle, and if you only have the headset communication, it's harder to get the plays out necessarily to your wide receivers. If you can signal to the wide receivers as they're running back down the field, the signals are up. They know where to go line up, and they can go get their play in. You can go a lot quicker in a 2-minute drill. If you don't necessarily have to talk to the quarterback, if there's not one central point, you can get everything from the sideline. That'll help.
Yeah. And I think, you know, it's going to be tough because unless you want to huddle, you cannot truly communicate the play to everybody. The quarterback can't communicate the play to everybody, and they don't huddle, really. Not everybody huddles. Sometimes they do, but not everybody wants to huddle in all situations. So in those situations, you want to communicate the play to everybody. The quarterback probably can communicate the protections to the offensive line, but in terms of the skill guys who are going to be spread out, unless they are, you know, obviously in a condensed set, but if they're spread out, then they can get their communication and their play from the sideline. Quarterback can talk to the O-line, and then you can kind of move things along quicker and make sure that everybody's on the same page.
And it does help too, and you have everybody set out there, and now Sark on the sideline sees that something is not right or the defense is set up in a way that he doesn't like, but he would like to check down to an audible. He doesn't have to call a timeout to make sure Quinn doesn't call the audible. He can just tell Quinn in the headset, hey, audible. You got to check down this.
If they're lined up quick enough, this is the thing we got to watch too.
Yeah.
Because the 15-second cutoff, remember, this became a huge advantage for Sean McVay until it wasn't because the NFL obviously is different. But he was using the same method.
Yeah.
Get Jared Goff to the line with about 30 to 25 seconds left on the play clock. Talk him through the defense. And then when the 15-second cutoff happens, Jared Goff doesn't even really have to process anything. He just has to do as he was told by Sean McVay. And it was a brilliant strategy that actually worked the entire season, which is crazy. The entire season until Bill Belichick finally said, okay, well, all I got to do is to put in a different defense. Prior to the 15-second cutoff, we shift after the 15-second cutoff, force Jared Goff to have to process on his own without the help and assistance of Sean McVay talking him through it, and then that advantage disappeared. But I'll say this. I don't know if college defenses will have the football IQ, football acumen, and the ability to adjust like a Bill Belichick coach defense in the Super Bowl and like NFL defenses can do. So it still may be an advantage depending on when they get to the line of scrimmage.
It is. I also thought it was interesting when he said he's asked about the defensive player to wear the helmet, but also keeping signaling on the defensive end. And we can play that. I'll play that clip for you right now. When he was asked about who he might have had the defense, where it may be, but also why they're going to have to keep signaling on the defensive end as well. Here's Sark talking about that.
Yeah, we're still going through that. It's, you know, I think the natural thing is like in the NFL, it's your, you know, one of your linebackers, the guy who's connected to the front and the back end that can communicate. But because of the space of college football, and because of the hashes and the width of the field, we've kicked around possibly it being a defensive back, maybe our star, because of where he aligns and that ability to communicate. So we'll see. We're still working through that. Again, it's still very new. And the idea that people aren't going to go no huddle just because there's a headset really isn't true. And so you're still going to have to signal some defensively as well.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to know who they're going to. If they worked with the quarterback with the headset communication, I'm sure they also worked with the defense with the headset communication. The problem is, unless they have multiple helmets with the technology in them, which I don't know if they do, and maybe they do, you would have to make sure that person, that main person, is always on the field. You know the quarterback's always going to be on the field. It would have to be somebody that you know is going to be on the field the majority of the time. Texas likes to rotate a lot of their defenders, especially in the back seven. Is Anthony Hill going to be that guy? That's a young player. That's a lot to put on a young player to be the quarterback of the defense and always, and also want him to play fast, learn multiple positions, and move him around the chessboard. Is it going to be Jadae Barron? If it is Jadae Barron, remember, they want to move him around too. They want to move him to corner. They want to move him to safety and star. You're going to move him around. If you're going to be a corner, he can't necessarily be the guy with the green dots that can communicate the plays. He's got to be closer to the central nervous system of the defense. And so I just wonder who that – it could be Makuba. But it whoever could. It is, you got to make sure that person's on the field a lot unless, like I said, they could have multiple guys with that technology, but then they wouldn't be able to be on the field together.
Yeah. And that's
only to be one at a time.
Yeah, so it'll be interesting to see where they put it. And I think you're going to see a lot of signaling on the defensive end. As he brought up, the other team's not using it. Yours is pretty much useless. Because if they're hurrying up and they're getting up to the line of scrimmage quick, you not have it being ready because you're waiting to hear from a guy who's listening in his headset is a huge disadvantage. So you have to signal on defense to make sure your guys are at least in the right formation and in the right spaces and in the right place and have an idea of what's happening. And then you can communicate to whoever has it. Watch out for this. You flip over, you know, you switch over here, move over a step. You can make those little adjustments as you're going, but you kind of have to have a quicker reaction time on defense. Because if the offense decides to go quick and you are waiting to hear from your linebacker where you're supposed to be, that's a touchdown.
No, you're right. You're going to force the defense into default coverages.
If there are
default coverages that basically if the coverage is not in and everybody's not on the same page, chaos has ensued, then there's kind of a blanket coverage that you play, probably a cover four or a cover three or something like that. But that's what you want if you're an offense, because then you know exactly what they're doing.
And that's also, we'll have to see. I'm assuming PK would be talking to the defense, not Sark. So if it's PK talking to the defense, talking to him about how much information he's trying to relay, because, you know, we know that's a different piece for a defensive coach, where Sark talking to a quarterback feels like he's wanted to do this for a long time. I don't know if PK has necessarily had that same mentality of, I really want to be in the ear of one of these guys. So it's kind of a PK. Who can he help the most? Who does he want to have their eyes out there? Who does he want to have that person? Because, you know, this isn't necessarily just a Sark thing. It's because he's not going to be the one in the headset.
Yeah, no, I can't wait to see who they decide on defense is going to be that guy, because basically that's the player who's going to be on the field more than any other defender for Texas. That's the only way to decide. It's got to be that person. Otherwise, you get into the complication of having multiple devices inside multiple helmets for multiple guys, and then they can't be on the field together. And then you got to have another helmet for those guys so they can be on the field together. It's a regular helmet. Like, it would be on the sideline, it'd be, that's a lot of chaos with, you know, making the rotations and moving guys around. I'm sure they can find a really good system for it. But I guess that's the only way to try to solve it, to give you multiple options for Texas. Have Jadae Barron, a helmet communication for Jadae Barron, but also a regular helmet. Have the same thing for Anthony Hill. Have the same thing for Makuba. And essentially, you can decide play to play, not play to play, but essentially series to series. And you could rotate play to play if you want to rotate those guys in and out. But then you would have the option for it to be an Anthony Hill, to be Jadae Barron, or to be Makuba.
Yeah, and
on
any
given series, you would have we can have different combinations of it, but only one of you guys can have the green dot on the field at the same time. But we can switch up who's going to have that green dot.
And I'm sure when the NCAA approves
it, can you do that? I don't know. Maybe that's against the rules.
Yeah, we'll know more when the NCAA officially provides the rules. If that is, I'm sure there will be a penalty if you have multiple guys out, which you would hate to get on a big third down.
No, you can't have multiple guys out.
Well, no, but and that's to say, on a third and four, and you don't switch the right helmet, and you just throw the guys out that you want out there, and the other team sees two green dots and runs over to the ref and says, 5-yard penalty, we pick up a first down. You know, those are the types. And that's not just a Texas problem. That will be across the board. Every team is going to have to make sure. We saw in a bowl game last year or late game last year, Florida sending two guys out in the same jersey number because it was a special teams number and then the defensive number, and they sent two guys out, and it ended up costing them a first down on a punt return, I think. So, like, those things happen because there's supposed to be guys on the sideline who are in charge of it all. But in the midst of a fourth quarter and big games, those are harder and harder to maintain, who's in charge and who's on the sideline and who's getting up to people and grabbing their helmets for players who are just trying to get in and out of the game. So I think you do really need it to be more centralized. And then maybe you have a guy who's not necessarily an every down player who plays a lot less, but is it the same position of who you have, that if that guy has to come out, that's the replacement. And basically only one position has it, and it's the guy in his backup. And that's really all you want to have come into that position. But again, when you say Jahdae Barron, Jahdae Barron would not necessarily have a backup if he's going to move around the field a little bit more. So you have to figure out where you're going to put it. It's just interesting. And I mean, that throws into the equation too. What if somebody, you know, it's easy enough on the offense. If your quarterback goes down for a few plays, well, your backup quarterback has it.
Yes.
But on the defensive side, if your linebacker goes down and that's your guy, well, then who's now the guy that has it? Who are you ready to put in to for the next eight plays, the next series? Or do you just not have it because that guy's on the sideline? So there'll be a lot of it. I'm sure we'll get more clarity of it when they announce, the NCAA announces what all the rules will actually be. But it is a lot you have to kind of worry about. And it's interesting that was basically as much as he talked about the defensive end. But I'm with you. I think the defensive end of where it's going to be and who's going to do it is just going to be an interesting piece to watch all the way basically up until next year. And then if they keep switching it throughout the year.
Yeah, I think matchup-wise, they could switch it too, just based on the matchups they have. You might want different guys, in different roles, depending on who you're playing against and what type of style offense you're playing against, that kind of thing. So it will be fascinating. And who knows? The NCAA could add one. I mean, you don't have to have one just like the NFL. You could go multiple. I do know my man CJ Vogel reported in a bowl game that Texas Tech, actually, I believe it was, used multiple headset sideline communications on offense, and one with the quarterback, one on the O-line, kind of one with the skill guys. And maybe that's a way to solve the problem, that you can't have multiple guys at different levels using the headset communication. But going to be fascinating to see what the defense does to adjust to it. All right, good stuff there. We'll come back. We got the big fat poll of the day coming up on the side. Also, we'll learn what the musically themed day of the week is. That's usually a lot of fun. And also, we'll come back and talk, obviously, a lot more Texas football on the other side as well. All of that and more right here on the Rodcast. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming back on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Let me tell you about Dr. U, Dr. Greg Eckert, and his fantastic team. As a matter of fact, I have to go visit Dr. U coming up a little bit later on this week. I'm looking forward to it, just to make sure that everything is status quo, make sure that everything is going well. And it is actually a huge debt of gratitude to Dr. Eckert and his team. When I went in for my last checkup, went in there for a checkup just to make sure everything was going okay, went in for a cleaning. Turns out the checkup was necessary, had some issues. My wisdom teeth growing in sideways. It could have become a disastrous, dire problem for me if I had ignored that. Thank God I didn't. I went to Dr. Eckert. They broke down the entire procedure to me, educated me about everything that was going to happen. I felt at ease about the process, even though it was a pretty extensive, evasive surgery. But I felt really good about the process. As a matter of fact, I was back at work in like 3 days, really easy. And now everything feels great, and I owe my man Dr. U a huge debt of gratitude, because my dental health has never been better. So it doesn't matter if it's something really serious like I had to deal with, or maybe it's just a cleaning or a checkup, general dentistry, teeth whitening, dentures, porcelain, crowns, veneers, dental implants, even full mouth reconstruction or root canal therapy, right? Even serious issues, or just, you know, your casual dental visit, doesn't matter exactly what your issue is, Dr. Eckert is the place for you. You've heard everybody somebody on these airwaves here on the horn talk about Dr. U as their dentist, and he should be your dentist as well. Dr. U does a great job. It's appropriate that we call him Dr. U because he's all about you to make sure you get the best quality dental care available. He also can give you a brand new smile in just one day, and you can call him about that as well. Give him a call, 512-345-3166, or visit drueckert.com, drueckert.com.
Back on a Wednesday morning here on the Rodcast. It is a one artist Wednesday where I'll play you songs from one artist all show long. Today's artist is Elvis. We'll be playing Elvis as he released his debut album in 1956. On this week in 1956, Elvis released his debut album. So we'll be playing a little Elvis all show long. I'm not the biggest Elvis fan, so I went in. I'm not the biggest one, but, you know, there's respect for Elvis. He did.
He's great. He's awesome. He's overrated, but he's awesome.
Yes. Yeah, I'm with you on that. So I thought I'd show him a little love because I have talked trash about him enough in my life that I'd show him a little love there.
I can truly say that. I agree. I haven't talked trash on him, but I believe he's overrated, but he's amazing.
Yeah.
You can be overrated and great. Because calling him the king of rock and roll is a bit of a stretch. That's it.
Yeah, I go
historically, that's a bit of a stretch, guys. I get it, but we now know now we can do some research. He's not the king of rock.
He's
and
not
roll.
The it's king not, of rock and roll. No.
Yes, he was just a great rock and roll superstar.
Yeah.
Iconic king of rock and roll.
Yes, his debut album came out in 1956 on this week in history. So we are playing Elvis for you all show long.
I like it.
That does bring us to the big fat poll today. Text lines open 512-447-3776.
Patrick's big fat poll of the day on the horn.
We talked about your favorite underdog performer of all time. Let's go with your favorite underdog team of all time today. Who is your favorite underdog team of all time? You know, the top one for a lot of people will be the Miracle on Ice, the 1980 America's Olympic team. That is probably the greatest underdog team story in American history. That's probably the one that, you know, you say the patriotism and everything involved in that is one. We can go if we want to talk March Madness, that NC State run in 1983 when they beat Houston, that had Akeem and Clyde and everybody on that, and that five slam of JAMA, that team in 83, that's a big one. If you want to go more recent, the Giants in 07 beating the Patriots, who were undefeated to that point, getting that win. That was a big underdog win to get there. And, I mean, these don't have to be people that won the championship either. Like, I listed people that won the championship. It could just be a great underdog team that exceeded all expectations but did not win the championship. I won't put that restriction on it. That they had to be champions to be the underdog story. But your favorite underdog team, the guys who fought through and overachieved for underdogs. Who is that on the text line? 512-447-3776 is the text line number.
Well, that's good. For a lot of Longhorn fans, it'll probably be the Shock the Nation tour. That Longhorn team. That was a good
one. Yeah.
Because that's why it was called Shock the Nation. Nobody expected them to make that kind of run. That was a good one. Honestly, good underdog teams. I hate to say it because it's definitely recency bias. This Texans team this year was a great underdog team.
They were.
Nobody thought a rookie head coach and a rookie quarterback would win the division and win a playoff game. I don't know if that's ever happened in the NFL history. I know it's been 100 years since a rookie head coach and a rookie quarterback won the division and went to the playoffs. Then they won a game in the playoffs. At the start of the season, I don't think anybody expected the Texans to do that.
I mean, this is how you know they didn't expect them is because when they traded for Will Anderson and gave up their first round pick, everyone had the Cardinals with the first and second pick. Because they said that the Texans would have the worst record again in the NFL. That was the thought was, if they're not the worst, they'll be bottom five. And they went in and won a playoff game. That it does. They were a big underdog story. The flip of that now means they're not underdogs anymore. They don't get you get to do it once. You don't get to continue the underdog story. So
that's why you get that first place schedule now. So things are a little bit different. But no, I just when you talk, we said underdog team. I thought I was like, man,
that is true.
That's the one that jumped out to me initially as a great underdog team. It's interesting. Does it honestly? I know it gets recency bias again. I feel like the Rangers were a big underdog. I feel like early on, nobody had the Rangers as a World Series champion.
The reason I'll put a caveat on that, and I think they were to an extent, because you're right. They definitely weren't expected
nobody
to do it.
Did.
But their payroll is big enough that it's hard. It's hard to say.
They were just ahead of schedule. They were ahead of schedule.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Yeah. Well, you just paid for all these top free agents. Now you want to say Scherzer, you trade for Scherzer, he gets hurt. You signed DeGrom, and he gets hurt. There was injuries in that add the underdog element of it. But yeah, I think there would be people, not Astros fans, but other fans across the league that don't have a payroll like that, that would say that the Royals a few years back when they made their run were more of underdogs, yeah, because they did not have the payroll. But I agree with you. They were definitely, it's a betting wise, underdogs for most of the season.
Yeah, no question. Like I said, I think I got a recency bias on that, but still, those are just nice underdog stories. So the question is, their favorite underdog, or
their
is
favorite?
It,
their favorite, because the best of all time.
So I'm saying Rangers fans. I'm sure it could be. That's probably their favorite. Texans fans. You might be looking at this tech. I mean, Texans are a young organization. They're really 22 years old, whatever they are. You might be looking at that as their favorite.
Yeah.
You know, the Texans. The Texans are an old team. What's the best underdog Texans team?
Yeah.
This past one.
Yeah. I don't know if any other one was that fun to watch.
Oh, hell no. They were,
I watched them a lot throughout the years. And no, I don't think there was any that was that fun.
No way. That we can't agree on. That's a good question, though. Best, your favorite underdog team. That'll be good, because everybody's got obviously a different team they're rooting for. Which one of those have been great underdogs? Or maybe you just got a team, period, that you enjoyed watching that captivated you, that was a really good underdog, no matter who they are. No, that's a really good question. I like that. All right, we'll come back. We'll get back to the big fat poll of the day conversation, but we'll talk Texas versus Colorado State. Now we know who the Longhorns men are going to play in the NCAA tournament. We'll break that down a little bit and talk about the matchup. Also, Cowboys fans. We'll talk about Cowboy free agency a little bit too. All that and more when the broadcast returns, featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming right back on the Horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. It is the Hump Day edition of the Rodcast, or One Artist Wednesday is the musically themed day of the week that we actually have a lot of fun with. And on Wednesdays, on One Artist Wednesdays, my man Patrick chooses one artist, go deep down the rabbit hole of the discography and the different songs from that particular artist, and basically plays you the top jams, or what he thinks are the top jams. How do you determine what songs to play from the artist?
So they're not on the top jams because I don't play a lot of ballads and stuff like that. So a lot of times ballads, but they're not great intro music here, and it's hard for us to, you know, listen to a song about just it's a straight ballad and then be like, Texas football's doing great. So, you know, you kind of pick songs that sound good as intro music. You try and look at those, and you pick the songs that are hits, but they're good.
They just got good energy.
Yeah.
It's about the energy.
You want to bring that up. And so there's a couple of songs that are a little bit slower in here because Elvis had a lot of that crooning a little bit, but
The ladies loved it, man.
But yeah, it's not a scientific process in picking them. It's more or less. I kind of put on a few different songs and see which ones I like, and then put them into a playlist, and then that's the ones we're going to use.
There you go. So One Artist Wednesday, because my man Patrick, the ideal, you know, always coming up with creative ways to keep the energy real good on the show. And also, he's not a music snob, a music enthusiast. So I let my man Patrick handle all things music on the show. Speaking of all things music, my man Nick Shuley is going to be coming in for Setlist ATX. That'll be in the 9 o'clock hour. We will get some golf conversation in at the turn. We're going to do that coming up with Charlie Wilson, Omar Uresti. If you don't know Omar Uresti, lifetime Longhorn professional golfer who lives here in the Austin area, was born here actually in the Austin area too. And Charlie Wilson, the president, CEO, and general manager of Callahan's, like you, a music enthusiast. He is a golf enthusiast, and we always enjoy when he comes on, talk a little golf with us. That'll be coming up at 8:30. Of course, been a lot of Texas spring football conversation. We've heard from Sark, went behind the burnt orange curtain. We'll get back to that conversation, I assure you. We'll talk some Texas football when we get into Raj Rant of the day. So we have not gotten done breaking down Texas spring football or hearing from Steve Sarkisian. We got some more audio that we have not gotten to, talking about the defensive side of ball, talking about the culture and leadership. We'll get to that coming up a little bit later on. But let's get into, we'll get to our horn headlines here, but we're also going to get into Texas versus Colorado State. We know now who the men are going to play in their first round game in the NCAA tournament. This is the team that Patrick said he did not think was the most favorable matchup for Texas. He thought going up against Virginia was the more favorable matchup, and damn if he wasn't right on the money looking at that matchup last night, because Virginia couldn't buy a bucket. That was some UGLY ugly offense, and now I wish Virginia was the team that Texas was going to be playing. Not that I think, you know, Colorado State is going to beat them. I think Texas is going to win, but it would have been a much better matchup for Texas, like the man Patrick thought, if they played Virginia, because Virginia's offense is terrible.
Yeah,
Charles Barkley would say it is bad.
Yeah, it was, and it's. I mean, it's not always that bad, but that was the worst of the worst when you score 14 points in the first half. And you can give some credit to their defense because they made Colorado State look god awful in the first half too. Colorado State did not look good in the first half either. They looked better in the second half. It looked like Virginia was just kind of a beaten team by the time they got in the second half because all their shots aren't falling, and it is not fun to play basketball when you can't hit the broadside of a barn. It's just not fun. And so I think there was a part of it where they were missing shots so badly, and then they were getting wide open shots in the second half and still missing them. So it made it so Colorado State was able to pull away. But, you know, if you watch, anybody who watched that knows that neither team looked great. However, we've seen Texas not look great a lot of times this season.
Yep.
Texas clearly has the talent advantage. Texas clearly has the athletic advantage. They don't have the size at guard, but they're not going to have that in almost any matchup. Because you have to have really short guards for them to have the advantage at size at guard with two guys that are around 6 foot for Texas. That's always going to be somewhat of an issue. But inside, you got there. Joel Scott for Colorado State played pretty well in the game, went inside. Virginia didn't have too many answers because they were able to hit some threes early, Colorado State was. And then they were able to go inside, and Joel Scott was playing well. Dylan DeSue just needs to stay out of foul trouble against him, and he should be able to defend him pretty well. Because it wasn't like he was putting on a display of great moves or anything else. He was just kind of bodying him up and getting inside and getting some shots up. But I think this is a team Texas can beat. They can play against this Colorado State team. Colorado State turned the ball over too many times in that game. It wasn't huge. It was a huge advantage. or a huge loss for them to turn the ball over, but they did turn it over too many times, weren't creating turnovers defensively. They weren't doing a ton against Virginia. Virginia's missed everything. So it wasn't like they were creating too much. So it does give you some more hope that Max A. Smith may be able to get a little bit more loose on this team and create something, because they weren't playing that, you know, shutdown style of defense. They were trying to shut them down a little bit, and Virginia just never got it going. There's a lot to look forward to. And the rebounding, they out-rebounded Virginia, but that's only because Virginia missed everything they took. So there's going to be a lot more defensive rebound opportunities. They only had 6 offensive rebounds. So there's nothing that you looked at in this game and thought, well, Colorado State really has that advantage. Colorado State had, what, 2 fast break points in the game? Like, there's nothing in it that made you look at Colorado State and think this team is going to dominate, this is a team to be really scared of. Now, Texas does have to watch that game last night and not get overconfident. Texas has to watch that game last night, which you know they were watching, and not think, well, let's get ready for Tennessee. You can't think that. You have to realize you have to go in and play this game against Colorado State. I think Colorado State will play better than they played last night, because it is, you know, when you're playing against a team who's missing everything and slowed the game down to a crawl, Texas slows it down. But, I mean, the first possession of the game was a shot clock violation.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That's how slow Virginia did it. Was let's really slow this down. We won't even get a shot up in that first.
It's like
possession.
You got a set play. It's the first play of the game. It's like the first series. Come on, man. You got a set play. So, you know what you're doing.
No. So Texas that's just wild. Needs to, you know, there's plenty of ways you can attack the paint. They don't necessarily have the size and the shot blocking for Colorado State that you can get inside against them. Dylan Mitchell should be able to get inside and get some points in this game. He should be able to rebound. If your guys attack on offensive rebounds, this is not a Colorado State team who, you know, is necessarily going to be able to get down court and run the ball and score a lot on you. And if you do, you're going to have to pull your defenders back, but you should be going for offensive rebounds in this game. You should be trying to get second chance points. And, you know, this is really much more of a Texas game than a Colorado State game. Because if Texas plays good enough basketball, they can beat Colorado State. This just goes down to Colorado State. If Texas does what they need to do, Colorado State does not have the talent on that team to go in and beat them. But Texas has beaten themselves multiple times this season already. We know that could be an issue. It's far from a sure thing. I haven't seen what the line is yet. I looked this morning. I hadn't seen it put out. But I have to imagine that Texas will be a favorite in this game. Watching that game last night made you feel good as a Texas fan that neither one of these teams looked like they were going to be world beaters, that you weren't playing a team that looks like upset. They're trying to make more of a narrative about how the Mountain West was screwed by the rankings committee, because basically they ranked everyone in the Mountain West pretty low. But then you saw why. Since they just don't necessarily have the talent level of players who are going to be able to go out and dominate at a high level. You know, they don't have enough scoring options that you're really worried that, you know, they're going to try and switch on to Max Asmus defensively. Yeah. But at the same point, you know, Clifford's going to try and do that. He's 6'6", so they'll try and get him over. But you could see Kendall Weaver come over on him, and Kendall Weaver can attack the basket. Not a great shooter, but they'd be able to attack the basket a little bit more. It's going to be one of those games. You'll be nervous until you play it because you don't know what can happen. It's March. There's a reason why they call it March Madness.
Damn right.
But overall, it was a game, stayed up to watch that one. It was just not a good game last night.
It was not enjoyable. No, I mean, I'm with you. I feel confident. You're right about Texas. Hopefully they're not overconfident. That could be something that comes back to haunt them. But I'm with you. Texas should have the advantage inside. Texas has the athletic advantage overall. So overwhelm them with athleticism. Be aggressive going to the basket. They should be aggressive defensively, forcing some turnovers so they can get in transition to get some of those transition buckets and showing off their athleticism that way and run. And I think Colorado State, their pace is good for Texas. They want to get up and down the floor too. Texas wants to get up and down the floor, and that essentially is going to, if they're going to play that style, Texas is going to beat them at their own game because Texas has the athletes to do so. So I feel good about it as long as Texas is not overconfident and Dylan Dessous doesn't get in foul trouble. There are a few things that could happen, and if those things happen, Texas could get in trouble. Dylan Dessous getting in foul trouble early on. Max Asim is having an off game, right? We've seen some of these things happen, but if it's a combination of those types of things happen, the slow starts, you know, we've seen that the dreaded cold streak offensively where they just go ice cold where nobody can get a bucket.
Yeah,
if they have one of those extended ones in the game, and then that on top of a Colorado State run, you know, those are the types of things that I think, oh, man, if you get a combination of those things, Texas could be in trouble. I doubt a combination of those things happen. Maybe one of those things will happen, but not a combination of them. And I think for Texas, that's what they need in terms of them beating themselves. As you
brought up. I'll have to go look and see how many possessions Colorado State played zone defense in this season. But I can imagine you may see some zone at points to just push Texas to see, can you outshoot us from three? Yeah. Because I think that's an easier way to beat Texas is make themselves shoot themselves out of a game. Get long rebounds to the guards and get the ball running the other way. I believe they would try it against Texas. Yeah. It's just a method. You know, if Texas hits the threes, you switch back to man and you give up on that experiment. But it wouldn't surprise me if that was something they tried to do in this game, just because, you know, you're trying to figure out anything you can to get an advantage.
Yeah, no, I like that idea too, honestly. Allow Texas to shoot themselves out of the game, because that's another thing we've seen.
Yeah.
With Texas on their side, settling.
IT Horton, Tyrese Hunter, if they're not hitting threes, and then if Max Asemus misses some because he's shooting them 6 feet behind the 3-point line instead of just taking a few steps forward and hitting the threes that we know he can hit at a high percentage.
Yeah, come on, guys. Don't settle. I like what Patrick always says. Get to the bucket, be aggressive, initiate contact. That's what I think we got to see a lot of from Texas in this matchup, because they don't necessarily have the rim protection to keep Texas away from the bucket. All right, good stuff there. Nice breakdown. We're going to continue to break down the Texas-Colorado State matchup. As a matter of fact, go to hornfm.com and you can join our bracket. Actually, we got a Horn bracket over there for March Madness. You can go check that out at hornfm.com. Man, Patrick's going to give you the Horn headlines, get you informed and educated on all the big headlines of the day. We'll review the big fat poll of the day after that, and then we'll get into Raj rant of the day, which of course is Texas football related. Let's do it. Hit with the Horn headlines, please.
All right, your Horn headlines here, brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball rallied late and walked off the game in 10 innings against Air Force last night. Jalen Flores hit a 2-run home run in the ninth to tie the game, and then D. Kennedy hit a shot to center field with the bases loaded in the 10th to win the game 6-5. Texas will have a quick turnaround as they will face Air Force again this afternoon at 4. Two more teams earned their ticket to the Field of 64 in the NCAA men's tournament last night, as Wagner withstood a late run by Howard to advance, and Colorado State had no problem with Virginia winning 67-42. The Rams held Virginia to 25% shooting on the game and will now focus their attention on the Texas Longhorns, who they will face on Thursday. In the NBA, the Rockets kept their play-in hopes alive with a 137-114 win over the Wizards, led by Jalen Green with 42 points. Houston now sits just 2.5 games back of the 10 seed. And the other two Texas teams were in action against each other last night, as the Mavericks held on to beat the Spurs 113-107 behind Kyrie Irving's 28 points and another triple-double from Luka Doncic. And if you're looking for some MLB baseball, it's been on since 5 a.m. this morning. Currently, the LA Dodgers are down to the Padres 2-1 in Ohtani's debut in South Korea, starting off the season early for the Dodgers and Padres. And that is your Horn headlines.
For the Horn headlines, we appreciate that. Before we get into Raj round of the day, Cowboys fans really got to get to this really quickly. Jonathan Hankins, also off the board.
Yes.
I thought he had been, you know, entertaining some teams and had made some visits, but it was announced yesterday or reported yesterday that he is expected to sign with the Seahawks on and I believe it's going to be a short-term deal. I haven't seen the details.
I thought it was a one-year deal.
Is it 1 year?
I
thought it was too, but I don't have confirmation. I thought I did, but it didn't say right here. Mike Garofalo is the one I saw with the tweet, but I'll do some research to find out. But I believe it's a short-term deal, and Patrick said he believes it's the same thing. And so a lot of Cowboys fans are probably upset that if it's a short-term deal, depending on the money, you know, why couldn't the Cowboys have brought him back? So now you're looking at it, a situation where, like I said, I don't know how the Cowboys are going to pull off this magical roster construction for this upcoming season, but there aren't enough draft picks and draft capital, and maybe they're about to, you know, trade and get a lot more draft capital, but they don't really have enough draft capital to address all the holes in the roster, really. Because now deep tackle definitely becomes one. You lost Neville Gallimore and you lost Jonathan Hankins. Now, you know, like I said, maybe they trust some of these young guys that they're bringing up that they already have signed.
You drafted Mozzie Smith last year, so you're hoping that he's going to take a step forward.
Could be that, but you still need depth there. You lost two of those guys who are in regular rotation. Your defensive end, you lost Dorrance Armstrong and Dante Fowler. So there needs to be some infusion of some depth there. You lost your tackle, Tyron Smith. You lost your starting center, Tyler Biadasz. Those are, I assume, what you're going to address in the draft. That's all the mock drafts have them going O-line early on in the first three rounds. So they're probably going to address those issues in the draft. But the third wide receiver, Michael Gallup, is gone. Your rotational complementary running back in Tony Pollard. I know you got Rico Dowdle, but you got to figure out something else at running back, too. I don't know if they got enough draft capital to figure it all out in the draft. Still a lot of time in free agency left, so there are a lot of good players still left out there. But they don't necessarily – they haven't manufactured enough salary cap space and, you know, and put themselves in a position to take advantage of the free agency market either. So I really – I'm a little confused as to how they're going to address the holes, or if they're just going to say, we like our guys that we got on the roster right now, even if they're unproven commodities, and we're just going to go with them and go with God, essentially.
Yeah, and have not re-signed Micah, have not re-signed CD, have not re-signed Dak. It is – the biggest troll job of Jerry Jones to say all in at the beginning of the season. That is, if he just hadn't said all in, all of this would be okay. Well, that's kind of weird. The fact that he said all in and this has been the offseason has really made it another level of trolling the Cowboys fans, because that is, I would not be happy if I was a Cowboys fan.
It's trolling. You can call it trolling. I think he gaslights them. I think it's gas.
Well, yeah, we know that. Yeah,
man. It's a straight up. He acts like y'all are crazy for like, what do you mean? Why don't we make some moves? And then they act like Cowboys fans that basically don't know what all in means, what the definition of all in means. Like, no, actually, your definition is different from ours. Means we going to re-sign our guys. And they still haven't re-signed their guys.
No.
He said the definition of all in was to re-sign their guys, and they haven't re-signed their guys. Like, what are you doing?
He said, well, you know, instead of one guy, you can get three or four. And you're like, you have signed three or four total.
Yeah, man, it's gaslighting. I don't know if he's doing it on purpose or whatever, but hey, the Cowboys, they love drama, like TNT, man. They do love them some drama. So Cowboys fans, it's out there. Real quick, Cowboys fans in the Mel Kiper mock draft. As a matter of fact, when we go into Rod's round of the day, we'll get into Daniel Jeremiah and Mel Kiper's mock draft. Both of them have the Cowboys addressing offensive line in the mock draft. Mel Kiper has the Cowboys taking Tyler Guyton, the offensive tackle out of Oklahoma, in his latest mock draft. And Daniel Jeremiah. By the way, Mel Kiper also mentions Jackson Powers Johnson, the Oregon interior offensive lineman for the Cowboys in the first round. But Daniel Jeremiah actually projects the Cowboys in his mock draft, the Cowboys are going to draft interior O-lineman Jackson Powers Johnson out of Oregon. So both Mel Kiper, Daniel Jeremiah have the Cowboys taking offensive line. So that would make sense. They're going to go O-line early on in the draft. It ain't sexy, but it is necessary for the Cowboys.
But, hey, if you looked at everything else they've done this offseason, who knows?
Yeah. They need to get more draft picks. They need more draft picks.
That trade that the Texans made to trade back in the second round, that feels like – and I know it for Cowboys fans, they'll probably also kill them not to have a first-round pick. But I think in the same sense, you're like, well, 2 seconds at least, that's maybe two guys that can start for you next year.
Honestly, Patrick, that's not a bad idea. I know Cowboys fans would hate it, but it depends on how many first-round grades they have. But they really need an offensive lineman. So you could argue that it's irresponsible because the best offensive lineman available for them may be gone by then. But they're at a draft now, what, 24? 24. Yeah, if the guys they have is the highest graded, best graded offensive lineman, if they're off the board, say they're on a random run on O-lineman or something, they're off the board, you could argue they should drop down. But I doubt an interior offensive lineman's going to get drafted. A lot of them get drafted much higher because they can go interior O-line or they can go, you know, tackle. They can go either one. They need both. Yeah. They can go best center. The best center probably will still be on the board by then.
Yeah, I mean, they got Biadasz, I think, fourth round. When they drafted him. So you can be able to get guys that'll be able to play. Biadasz also sat for at least a year before he came in. So there is that he was not a rookie starter. So you're going to have to figure out what you're going to do. But yeah, I mean, at this point, you kind of feel like they have to add more draft picks because they're at, right now it, without they're well, they're just at if any you miss at any position, that's it.
I'm with you. Yeah, I'm with you. You got to have a home run draft. You're basically banking on a home run draft. You're,
yeah,
that's crazy. That's I mean, everybody knows that's flawed logic. I mean, the draft is essentially a lottery. I mean, it's a crapshoot for the most part.
Yeah, and I mean, when when we say home run draft, we're talking through six rounds.
You're saying, talking about hitting on every guy in the first 5 to 6 rounds. Like, yeah, that's absurd.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Like, you need race success rate. You need Brock Purdy level of success the entire draft.
Yeah.
No, that's
I'm with you.
I have to assume they're going to make some trades at some point. I have to assume that is, you know, that they'll realize there's certain positions they have to kind of address, and it won't be the top names. You have to assume that, but it is.
What you're going to trade? You're going to trade draft picks because you need them. You can trade future draft picks, I guess. But honestly, right now you need them draft picks. And the Cowboys, they build their roster mostly through the draft. So trading away draft picks for them, even I'm with you. I like the trade idea, but man, like I said, they can't be trading away too many draft picks. They need that cheap labor because you're about to have to pay Micah, CD, and Dak. You need cheap labor badly. So what do you trade? You can trade players, but you know what player you think on the Cowboys they want to trade? You can trade some of those DBs actually.
Yeah, that's Deron again. Bland. I've said Deron Bland is a guy I've said before it's that is bro. He is you the trade best tradable asset you have. Because his salary is like $1.5 million this year. He's got another year on top of that. So he's
sign Stephon Gilmore and trade Deron Bland. I'm not opposed to that. I know that some people are like, that's crazy. It's not that crazy, actually. It makes a lot of sense for where the Cowboys are.
Yeah, and if you were able to get some value back for him and multiple picks to help you build this roster, if that's the way they can do it. I mean, that's I know it's not the best, but that's something that I would at least be shopping if I was them.
No, that's not. That's not a bad idea. Mel Kiper's latest mock draft. He's got the Longhorns that are going here are Byron Murphy at 19 to the Rams. He's got Xavier Worthy going 26 to the Bucks. Oh, Hank playing with Baker Mayfield. And he's got the Chiefs taking A.D. Mitchell, number 32 overall. So he's got three Longhorns going in the first round. That would be the first time the Longhorns had three draft picks in the first round since 1980, I believe. Last time was when Rod B was born. He's got two wide receivers going, and he's got Xavier Worthy now going ahead of A.D. Mitchell, when usually at least most of the mock drafts had A.D. Mitchell going ahead of Xavier Worthy. If you look at Daniel Jeremiah's latest mock draft, just to go through it here really quickly, he's got Byron Murphy as the first Longhorn taken, but all the way at 27. And then he's got A.D. Mitchell going to the Kansas City Chiefs at 32. So there you go. So that Kansas City Chiefs, everybody had the Kansas City Chiefs taking X-Man. Then they go out and get Hollywood Brown. one-year deal with a speedster. Now everybody's got to take an A.D. Mitchell. So Kansas City's going to get them a Texas wide receiver. That's what's going on here. We know that.
Maybe they just kept hearing rumors about a Texas wide receiver they liked, and then now they figure it's a different Texas wide receiver.
That's a good point, Patrick. Actually, you're right about that. It could just be, man, they like them. They like that Texas boy, and it's like, which one? Which one of the Texas boys they like? And you're right. Now it's just switching. It's like, nah, maybe now it's not X-Man because they signed Hollywood, who's kind of an X-Man type of receiver. Interesting. Good stuff there. That's good stuff. All right, we come back. We'll get into Rod's rant on the other side. I have a rant for you. We'll play some Sark sound and audio as well, and then we'll get to a Pro Day. It's a topic about Pro Day. Who's got the most to gain at Pro Day today? That's with so many different topics. We're not even discussing Pro Day, but it will be happening today. We'll have the results of that tomorrow. But I'll tell you who has the most to gain at Pro Day. All of that and more when we return right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming back on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Let me tell you about our friends over at Callahan's, because they got a lot of great things over there, goodies for you. If you're interested in making sure that your yard looks golf course ready, that is a healthy yard, that you want to have the lawn of the month in your neighborhood, which I'm trying to do, our friends over at Callahan's, they have great resources for you, great advice on how to make your yard look even better, how to take care of your lawn, but also great resources for you as well. We know that spring is upon us. Spring is coming early this year, and Callahan's can help you make sure that your lawn is in golf course condition. We had my man Charlie Wilson on earlier last week, and we're going to have him on actually today at the turn coming up at 8:30. Well, I had to ask him, because he's the president, CEO, and general manager of Callahan's. I had to ask him about, hey, how do I make sure that my yard is the best yard on the block? I'm trying to win some awards here. He said, hey, put the pre-emergence down. He said, such as a barricade product from Nitrofos to keep the weeds away initially in the next few weeks. And I already did that. I got to tell you, I've already seen the results of it. My yard's already looking pretty good, but I'm not done. He said, once you're done with that, you want to get your weed and feed down to grow the good grass, keep the crab grass and the dandelions out of your yard. And then you get the nighttime temperatures, which are getting a little bit, starting to drop down a little bit, getting closer to the mid 60s, right about that. And then you want to get the Bermuda seed. That's kind of one of the last stages to fill in the gaps where some of the grass has died, gotten sun damaged or damaged from the winter freezes. So the entire process, my friends at Callahan's, they'll help you through the process as well. You tell them exactly what you want, and they have all the resources, the bags of soil for you. They got the amendments, special fertilizers to get your lawn back into a beautifully lush and healthy looking yard. And I'll give you guys updates on how it's going. But right now it's going really, really well. It can go well for you. Don't forget, also, it's time to start begin planting those seedling vegetables for your gardens. Callahan's has all your supplies there, weekly variety of tomatoes, melons, and peppers, and all these plants. If you got that green thumb, trust me, Callahan's is the place for you. And it's time to start planting your native pecan and fruit trees so that you can enjoy those for generations to come. They have that at Callahan's. And don't forget, with Easter arriving early this year, be sure to check out their baby chicks. They got the ducklings and the rabbits. The kids will enjoy that while you go to Callahan's, and you get all your supplies to make sure the yard is looking good. They got everything you need there at Callahan's between downtown and the airport, 501 Bastrop Highway. You know the spot, and it's always a good day to make it a Callahan's day. Welcome back to the Rodcast. Time for Rod's rant of the day. We just talked about the latest mock drafts. The mock drafts from Mel Kiper and the latest mock draft from Daniel Jeremiah. And those guys have, well, at least Mel Kiper has three Longhorns going in the first round. He's got Byron Murphy, Xavier Worthy, and A.D. Mitchell going in the first round. Daniel Jeremiah's got two Longhorns going in the first round, Byron Murphy and A.D. Mitchell. He actually, both of those mock drafts have A.D. Mitchell going to the Kansas City Chiefs, which is very different than the immediate post combine mock drafts by guys like Dan Lance Zierlein and Dane Brugler, and even Mel Kiper before the NFL combine, he actually had Xavier Worthy going to the Kansas City Chiefs, and now all that has flipped. Looks like A.D. Mitchell may be the popular pick for the Kansas City Chiefs. Either way, if a Texas wide receiver ends up with Patrick Mahomes, we all agree that guy's winning. that guy's won the lottery pretty much. But anyway, those guys will be at NFL Pro Day today. At Texas. Now, a lot of those guys, since they worked out and had such great combine performances, I doubt X-Man, I doubt A.D. Mitchell, I doubt Byron Murphy workout. But there are some guys like Jalen Ford, who will probably be really busy at Pro Day because he didn't do a lot at the NFL Combine. There'll be J.T. Sanders probably does some stuff at the – I think X-Man and A.D. Mitchell may run routes, do some of the routes and drills. But, you know, I think the guys in terms of doing actual testing – I don't know if Ryan Watts will test either because he had such good combine numbers. Usually guys who have good combine numbers don't test at the pro day. And if you don't do some of the combine events and drills, then you'll make up for those at the pro day. So for Texas, you know, I think Keelan Robinson will probably do some things because I think he passed on a lot of the drills at the combine, but he'll probably keep his 40 and will pass on run the 40. Like I said, Jay Witt among the players will do everything. He's probably the only guy I'm thinking of right now that'll do everything. Even Jalen Ford may come close because Jalen Ford only did broad jump and he only did the vertical.
Yeah.
But Jay Witt didn't do anything but interviews and I'm sure medical exams. And so he's got to do everything. Big day for Jay Witt. Jay Witt's got to run a fast time. He's got to look good. And he's going to be tired as hell. This is going to be like – it's going to be like an hour and a half, two-hour workout for him because he's going to do every testing drill. And he's going to go through individual drills with them, and then he's going to run routes.
Yeah.
So he's going to do everything. A lot of the guys come, they're just going to do one or two things like, hey, man, I'm coming to do this, this, and this, and then I'll do some drills for the scouts, and then I'll go run some routes. He's got to do all of it. So the busiest guy at the pro day will be Jay Witt. The guy with the most to gain at the pro day actually won't be Jay Witt. It'll be Quinn Ewers. Now, Quinn Ewers ain't coming out this year. But Quinn Ewers is throwing at the Texas Pro Day. And it'll be the first time NFL scouts get to see him this close and get to see him interact with his teammates, get to meet the man. And a lot of times when you're drafting a player, especially in the first round, and you're drafting a player that's going to be a potential franchise quarterback, the face of your franchise, the person that you're drafting is just as important as the player that you're drafting. It doesn't matter at every position. I heard Dion say this, and he's right. It don't matter at D lineman. My D lineman, I don't give a – I ain't worried about him and being, you know, the most outstanding human being and all that. I mean, you know, we hope that he is, and we would like that. That's ideal. But he's a D lineman. Yeah, he's a DB. It's okay. He's a wide receiver. But at quarterback, we all agree it's a different spotlight.
Yeah.
It's a different spotlight at quarterback. Right. And they get to meet the man, Quinn Ewers. Now they get to meet the person and get to watch the player. Now he's going to look great because he's going to be able to touch everybody to grass. He's going to be throwing the receivers he's been throwing to for the last 2 years. He's going to look really good out there in shorts. And the coach, I think the scouts are going to salivate over that part of the evaluation of him. Cause yeah, why wouldn't you evaluate Quinn Ewers when you're there looking at the other guys, right? If you're an NFL scout, you kill two birds with one stone. That's what NFL scouts do. What I think is going to be more telling is the way he carries himself. Like, body language doesn't whisper. It screams. It yells. And the way he carries himself as a quarterback, does he look like the kind of guy, does he carry himself in a manner that implies that he could be the first quarterback taken overall, the face of the franchise, the alpha male of alpha males in that locker room, right? This is going to be his chance. You don't get a second chance to make a first impression. So a lot of the scouts that are there, GMs that are there, execs that are there. Texas had 11 guys at the combine. They're going to be a lot of NFL scouts that go, man, I'm going down there. NFL execs to go, no, I'm going to go down there. First of all, they like Austin. So they're going to come down to Austin to kick a little bit. Yeah, free trip to Austin, go kick a little bit. But also, Texas has a really talented team overall. So they may come down here and watch spring practice too. They may come down and say, you know what, Kevin Banks is going to be a first-round pick next year too. And this kid, this Quinn, you know what? I'm gonna go down there and watch spring practice. I'll just get knocked out. I'll go down there. I'll go watch spring practice a little bit. I'll go down there and then I'll take in the pro day. So it might be one of those types of things. So they'll get a really good look. That's what scouts started doing in terms of saving time because they're always on the road, visiting different places. Happens in all the sports. Like, no, I'm gonna go somewhere where I can watch as many great athletes as possible and I can get evaluations on all those guys. Why they love going to Georgia and used to love going to Bama because hell, man, how many NFL players on that roster? Freshmen, sophomores, and you know, juniors, and you can already start building up your evaluation, your dossier on players. Like, okay, yeah, this Anthony Hill kid, I got some notes on him, coach. Actually, I got some notes on him from back in his, like, that's what scouts do. They really, that's exactly how it breaks down. And for Quinn Ewers, your first chance to make a really good impression on those NFL scouts is today. I'm not worried about the throwing. He's gonna do that. I'm worried about him. I'm not worried about it, but I want him to show he's got that it quality. It's a great story Mac Brown tells about DKR. He was actually hanging out with the late, great Daryl K. Royal, Willie Nelson, and George Strait. Sounds like some kind of a joke, but it ain't. And they were hanging out at the stadium, and it was doing a coaching clinic. And one of the high school coaches sees this group of icons and has the scones to walk on over there. And I give it up for him for walking over there, because I don't know if I would if I saw DKR, Willie Nelson, George Strait, and Mac Brown having a conversation, cracking it up. And I'm going to come in there and intervene. No, this coach did, though. And he intervened. He said, Coach Daryl K. Royal, I love you. You're amazing. I want to be like you. How do I do it? How can I be like you? And Coach Royal told him straight up, if you have it, you'll make it. If you don't have it, you won't make it. And if you don't know what it is, you don't have a chance to make it. And Mac said that young coach just looked bewildered and stupefied and didn't say anything. He just kind of looked away and walked off. I guess DKR blew his mind. And Mac Brown says that DKR looked at everybody in the circle and said, hell, he ain't got it. And basically, like, that coach ain't got it. It took me 90 seconds to figure out, well, he ain't got it. I think that is kind of how I see Quinn Ewers' impression on these scouts. Do you have it? They'll know in the first 90 seconds to 3 minutes that they get a chance to meet you. They say that women decide in the first 90 seconds whether you are worthy of being a mate or not. It takes 90 seconds to about 3 minutes, and she's already got a mind made up, like, yeah, I would, or I wouldn't, or there's no way. It's real quick. It don't happen. Like, it's not something over a long period of time. She makes her mind up pretty quickly. Now, you may not know that. She may not let you know that, but she knows. And that's what the first impression, I think, how powerful they can be. And for Quinn, today is going to be huge for him in that regard.
Yeah, it'll be very big. And you know, what he can carry himself in that room. Can he walk into a room full of guys that are going to be going to the NFL, going to be top picks, and look like the man? Because if you can look like you're the guy who's in charge in the room full of guys who are about to be drafted, then you can be the guy to lead a locker room and the NFL. And that's what you kind of want to see him be able to pull off in this game today. And like, I think there's going to be other fun storylines. You know, they're going to be looking at Tavondre Sweat to see, you know, how big he is after the combine, because they see him and they go, okay, is he maintaining weight? Is he losing weight? Is he gaining weight? They're going to watch Tavondre Sweat's weight just to.
That's right.
You're because right. It is the story, you know, you worry about guys like that because there's too many stories in the NFL of a guy getting there and then putting on an extra 30 and all of a sudden he can't do what his explosion's gone and everything kind of goes away. So they're going to be watching that. I think JT Sanders is a guy they're going to be looking at a lot because he didn't necessarily jump off the page at the combine, but he's also the number two tight end. So anybody who's looking for a tight end is trying to figure out where in the draft he might fall and where they can get him. They're going to want to talk to Jonathan Brooks more because he's a top running back and teams still need running backs. And they're trying to figure out where he is and his health and his, you know, all right, we're going to ask him how many invasive questions can we talk to him about on the sideline to try and get him to fess up of how long he thinks he's still going to be out for, when he thinks he's going to be a full running back again, when can we get him on the field? So when they ask me in the meeting, what week is he going to play for us? I can give them a real answer versus, mm-hmm. well, he says he'll be ready week one. Or, yeah. or I man, we were trying to talk to doctors and we were trying to talk to staff. And we were talking to the other guys, what they heard. We were talking to every coach, what they heard and what this injury could mean. And we think it's week six. We think it's week eight. And I think those are the conversations. But those guys are, to me, some of the bigger stories. And it is. It's Quinn's day to show off to everybody because everybody else has done enough at the combine that they're all going to be there. And Jay Witt is, you know, has to go and prove it because of his injury. But we kind of know where Jay – I don't know if Jay Witt is the intangibles or if the physicality guy that you're going to see his – you know,
I mean, his numbers, athlete, but he's had so many injuries. I just wonder if he still has that.
Yeah. You know, I think he's much more a guy that you're going to see go out there and, yeah. and realize what he does. I think his will be them talking to the other coaches there. And the gleam in their eye when they talk about Jay Witt is going to be with the scouts. Go. They talk about Jay Witt in a different way at Texas. Every player talks about him different. Every coach talks about him different. I think you see that from him. But, you know, I think if JT Sanders can improve any of his odds because he really kind of slipped down after the combine because he wasn't an athletic marvel. It's a good player, you know, great player, can do all these things, but he's not the athletic freak on top of it. But that's just a fun storylines. You'll get to hear what comes out of it and scouts trying to then you'll hear the other side of scouts trying to whoever they talk the most bad about after this, the most bad reports. Is the guy that everyone's trying to push back in the draft and steal later. That's yeah. remember that Texas fans is if anybody's yeah. talked bad about, that's not necessarily a bad thing. That scout's trying to spread misinformation so that they can get the guy in the third or fourth or fifth round or whatever it is.
They call it the silly season for a reason.
Yep.
All right. We come back. We'll get into what the facts on the other side, some random factoids and stats from around the sports world. We'll share with you when we come back right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers right here on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Austin is a great city. We know this. We complain about the traffic. Who doesn't complain about the traffic in Austin? But the reason there's so much traffic in Austin is because so many people keep moving to this great city, making it one of the fastest growing cities in America. And as our city continues to grow and thrive, so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local 482. Now, many of the iconic landmarks that we love in this city that make it so unique and to make it so aesthetically pleasing were actually built by the hands and the skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local Union 482, like the Pennybacker Bridge and D. Care Stadium. And the folks at Ironworkers Local 482 don't go to the office. They're the ones who actually build it. So if you're looking for an exciting employment opportunity or you want a refreshing career change, you can become a member of Ironworkers Local Union 482. Right now, they're hiring over 3,000 people. They got a huge project happening right here in Central Texas. They're offering competitive wages, competitive benefits, even a pension plan. They're even offering training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program. So you're out of excuses. Look up my friends over at Ironworkers Local 482 right now and become a member of this prestigious organization, and you'll take pride in the type of teamwork and craftsmanship that helps shape the future of our great city. So go online today at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right, time for what the facts are, what the stats. Colorado State will be the opponent for the Longhorn men in the first game in the NCAA tournament. Colorado State beat Virginia by 25 points as a 2.5-point favorite, covering the spread by 22.5 points. That is the most points by any Mountain West team has covered. That is the most points any Mountain West team has covered the spread by, I should say, in an NCAA tournament game ever. How about that?
All right.
Yeah. Mountain West. But the Mountain West actually doesn't do well in the tournament. How about this? The Mountain West Conference, you go look at it, the double-digit Mountain West Conference seeds are 1-26 all-time in the tournament, with only 6 of those losses by 7 or fewer points. Colorado State is Mountain West, baby.
They are Mountain West.
There you go. Yeah. They were actually 0-4 in the play-in, but Colorado State got them a W prior to them getting
the W. I got one for you for March Madness for helping you fill out your brackets. Since 2002, every national champion has finished the season ranked top 40 in KenPom adjusted offense and top 25 in KenPom adjusted defense. There's 9 teams in the bracket who fit this criteria. So these are your possible champions according to that stat since 2002. Houston, Creighton, UConn, Marquette, Purdue, Tennessee, Auburn, North Carolina, and Arizona. Those are the 9 teams that, according to that stat, have a chance to win the national championship. The rest of the 64 don't matter.
I would knock out Arizona out of that because a team, no team west of Texas has won a men's college basketball national title since 1997. So you can have them going a little deep, but I wouldn't have them winning at all. Just know that any team west of Texas, it just wouldn't matter who they are.
No. Yeah, there's a bunch of them. I was watching a video yesterday where they broke it down to Purdue had to be the champion because of stats. That there's only team that Purdue is the only one that fits every single one of the conditions of the past. But it started to go down to like last 5 years. And once you start to get into that, it's a trend, but it's not necessarily, you know, the 2002, when that's the reason you said that in the West is 25 years. Once you put 20 years on it, then it starts to look a little bit more. But 5, I'm a little more, you can have an outlier 5 years that there's a change after that.
Totally agree with you.
So the 20-year ones are more interesting, though.
Yep, I'm with you. If I get a stat that's anything a decade or more, I start looking at it. But if I get 15 years or something, I'm like, oh, yeah, that's money. I'm taking that.
Yeah.
I'm taking that one. That's why I love filling out my bracket, because I just got – that's why I fill it out. I fill it out based on those trends. I find the best trends, or at least the ones that are going the longest, and I just kind of build my bracket backwards that way. Good stuff there from what the facts, what the stats. That's what tomorrow's show will be all about, because we'll be breaking down our brackets a little bit on tomorrow's show, and, of course, talking about Texas, Colorado State a little bit more. All right, we come back. We'll get into some Steve Sarkisian audio talking about the first day of Texas spring practice. We also got At the Turn coming up at 8:30. We're going to bring in Omar Uresti, who is a pro golfer. Also, our man Charlie Wilson, the CEO of Callahan's. We're going to talk some golf. Got some golf storylines, too. You got man Scottie Scheffler winning the Players Open back-to-back, first golfer ever to do that. And also, there's been a bit of a controversy. There's a controversy at the Players Open that I want to talk to, the Players Championship that I want to talk to Omar Uresti about as well. So we'll get into that at After Turn. But when we come back, we're talking lots of Texas spring football. So don't go anywhere. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers right here on the Horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers. You can hit us up via Twitter. I'm at Rod Babers in the Twitterverse. Patrick's at It's Patrick Davis. He's at It's Patrick Davis in the Twitterverse. He's also known as the Idealionaire here on the show. Comes up with all the creative ideas, especially with the musically themed days of the week. And Wednesday is a one artist Wednesday. Chooses one artist and goes deep, deep, deep down their catalog and their discography and comes up with the best jams to play on the show just from one particular artist. And today he chose what a lot of people call the king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley.
Yes, his debut album came out this week in 1956.
Okay.
So that is where we're going this week with the One Artist Wednesday.
Drove women crazy because he started like moving and gyrating his hips.
Yeah, when they had a they had a pan up.
Moving his crotch a little bit.
They had a pan up because he gyrated his hips.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, moving his crotch too much for them. They didn't like crotch movement back then.
No, I think twerking may have killed some people back in the day.
Yeah, exactly. They thought that was the devil. It was like, oh, the devil are in his hips because his crotch is moving too much. And now crotch movement, you know, is part of like everyday. It's kind of everyday body language for anybody singing and jamming. We do it all day in everyday society.
Is it canon that
you didn't do it?
Forrest Gump taught him that? Can't Forrest Gump tell him?
No, I mean, it's yeah, seriously. Yeah, that's a good one. I like that, man. Elvis Presley, I always said this, I'm not hating on Elvis Presley because I actually like Elvis Presley. I do believe he was a tad overrated. Calling him the king of rock and roll may have been a bit of a stretch when you do the research. He's awesome. He's amazing. He's iconic. But the king of rock and roll, I don't know if I'd call him the king of rock and roll. But I'm certainly an Elvis Presley fan. All right. Also, I'm a fan of Steve Sarkisian, which I think we all are at this point. And Steve Sarkisian spoke to the media after Texas' first spring practice. So we'll hear from Coach Sark. We'll also get to our horn headlines from my man Patrick Davis to get us informed and educated on all the big stories of the day. We'll also get back to the conversation about Texas men's basketball. We know who they'll be facing in the first round of the NCAA tournament. They'll be facing off against Colorado State. So we'll get to that here coming up. And also next segment, we got at the turn. We'll be joined by Omar Uresti, who's a pro golfer. Also, we'll be joined by my man Charlie Wilson, and he is the CEO and the general manager of Callahan's General Store, but a golf enthusiast, passionate about golf, especially here in the state of Texas, here in Austin, but also what's going on nationally. So I'll ask him about Scottie Scheffler. We'll talk about that a little bit, and we'll also get into some interesting drama from the Players' Championship, too. All right, let's get to the horn headlines, and then we can pivot quickly and get to some Sark audio and start talking some Texas spring football. So, Patrick, hit us up with the horn headlines.
All right, your horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball rallied late and walked off the game in 10 innings against Air Force last night. Jalen Flores hit a two-run home run in the ninth to tie the game, and then D. Kennedy hit a shot to center field with the bases loaded in the 10th. To win the game 6-5. Texas will have a quick turnaround as they will face Air Force again this afternoon at 4. Two teams earned their ticket to the field of 64 in the NCAA men's tournament last night as Wagner withstood a late run by Howard to advance, and Colorado State had no problem with Virginia winning 67-42. The Rams held Virginia just to 25% shooting on the game and will now focus their attention on the Texas Longhorns, who they will face on Thursday. In the NBA, the Rockets kept their play-in hopes alive with a 137-114 win over the Wizards, led by Jalen Green with 42 points. Houston now sits just 2.5 games back of the 10 seed. And the two other Texas teams were in action against each other last night as the Mavericks held on to beat the Spurs 113-107. Kyrie Irving had 28 points, and it was another triple-double for Luka Doncic. And over in MLB, an early opening day for the Dodgers and Padres as they are playing this morning in South Korea, kicking off MLB season. The Dodgers have rallied now and are up 5-2 in the bottom of the ninth. They will play another game tomorrow, also a 5 a.m. start Central Time for your MLB beginnings if you want to start the season early. And that is your horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the horn headlines. Yeah, I swear, the game, the Dodgers Padres game over in, is it, what you say is over in
South
where
Korea,
is it
I believe South Korea
right now. I didn't know. I don't think Major League Baseball did a great job of promoting that. They need to promote that more. That they kind of went under the radar. And I know over here it's on, you know, whatever, four in the morning, something like that, 4 or 5 in the morning. But still, they got to do a better job promoting that. Most human beings did not know there's a Major League Baseball game being played. And this is not an exhibition, right?
No, I think they realized if they made it an exhibition, then they weren't even going to send their top guys.
Yeah.
So no, I think they had to make it a real game. But, yeah, it is. They're trying to show off Shohei Ohtani, make it a world game with Shohei. You know, so I get why they're doing it. They also didn't want to, you know, once you start the season, you want to have the guys back and on the right time schedule and everything else. So I get why they did it, but it does lead to a weird soft start to the MLB season because it won't be starting up here for another week, which, by the way, if you guys do want to hear, the Rangers will still be here at the Horn. Your World Series champion Rangers will be on the Horn. We'll be playing all of their games starting up here at the end, starting next week, I believe. Next week is when we start them up, Thursday of next week.
Dodgers get the win 5-2. There you go. So we're good point to put it, the soft open, if you will, the soft start to the season for Major League Baseball. Well, it is hopefully not a soft start for Texas spring football. And Sark did say that the team looked really good early on. As a matter of fact, let's hear from Steve Sarkisian after the first practice of spring football. He did speak to the media, talked to them about a number of different topics. This is his first impressions of his team after the first day of spring practice. Here's Steve Sarkisian.
For us, this was a pretty good first day. You know, and I'm always hesitant to lay too much praise after one practice. Like I'm always a little hesitant to be too critical after one practice. But I thought that it was pretty evident that the energy was really good out there at practice. It was pretty evident the amount of depth that we have. I mean, this is the most numbers that we've had in a spring practice since we've been here. And, I think that's a combination of a few things. I think the transfer portal has affected that, where you can have guys, you know, kind of replace players right away. I think that's a byproduct of so many early admits, guys coming mid-year. And in the end, you know, the fact that we were able to two spot all of our team stuff in practice, and that we were able to go ones, twos, threes, and fours, and everybody on the team getting reps and improving and getting better. I thought the coaches really, you know, demanding the fundamentals, the techniques that are needed in all three phases, offense, defense, and special teams, was evident as well today. But again, there's a ton of things that we need to get better at and we need to work on. But for a first day spring practice, I was definitely pleased.
So Sark said he was pleased with the first day of practice, and he's right about how deep they are. We know they lost a lot of talent, 11 guys participated at the NFL combine, and they'll have, you know, anywhere from 6 to 7 guys drafted potentially. I mean, Texas is going to have a lot of guys drafted as well. So they did lose a lot of talent, but they're going to have essentially 25 new additions, either summer enrollees, early enrollees, or transfer portal additions. That's a lot of new additions in just one spring. So a lot of new faces, but all guys that this staff has recruited. So their body types that they like, the guys who have the skill sets that they like. So the team looks very different and looks like a Sark team. Sark was asked about the versatility of this group, about their different ways to win. I mean, last year it was led by the rush defense because your front seven was so good last season. It was led by your offense, which was a high-powered offense until it got to the red zone. But they were an offense where they had a lot of weapons too. He was asked about the versatility of this group going forward. What does he see? Here is Steve Sarkisian talking about the versatility of the team.
Well, I think we have that as well again this year. You know, I would say just as a team in general, I don't think we're going to be a one-dimensional team that's going to have to rely on one phase of the game to be overly just dominant. I'd love for all three phases to do that, but I think we're going to be – when the dust settles, we're going to be a really good offensive team that will have balance. I think we're going to be a very good defensive football team. That's going to be able to have some versatility and man zone and pressure things. And I think we're going to be really good on special teams. You know, just a couple glimpses I saw today, we've got quality returners. We're always going to be aggressive in our intent in the way that we call it. And so for us, when we've got that balance in all three phases with the quality of players that we have, ideally that sets that versatility up for us where we can win games a multitude of ways. But that's, like I said, that's going to be a process and take some time. I will say, just first glimpse offensively, we've got some really versatile players offensively, you know, and from a receiver standpoint, we were moving guys from outside to inside, playing them in the slot, playing them outside. We moved our runners around probably more today than we have a first practice of spring ball, and trying to play to their strengths as well. And I think that helps when you've got really experienced quarterback who really understands the offense and he can manage some of that stuff at the line of scrimmage.
He still won't use the term, but he references it often. He won't use the term positionless football, but he'll say every other term, and he'll describe it a lot. Oh, we moved these guys around to different spots, and we put our running backs at wide receiver. He is thinking more along the lines of positionless football, Patrick. He just won't say it, but even with the defensive backs, right? We talked about this yesterday with Jadae Barron, the versatility, cross-training all these guys. And I've said for years, positionless football is the future of football. So you don't have to major in it like Shanahan does on offense, but you should minor in it. You should dabble in it. You should sprinkle your offense and defense with hybridism and multiplicity. And I think that's what he's referencing there, even though he won't use the term.
Yeah, I don't know if it's because he just doesn't want to use the term, or if it's a you know, intentional thing, because players don't necessarily want to be thought of as positionless. They want to be specialists. Right. So he doesn't want to say, well, this guy can play five different positions. They say, no, I am this. This is what I do. So I think that it may be intentional why he doesn't use the word positionless. But he is. He definitely wants that versatility, and he understands. And he's coaching to the players. A different way of saying it is, if you want to stay on the field, if you want to keep staying, if you want to be in there, well, you have to be able to use you in every situation. You have to be more versatile. Versatility is the key for you to be able to stay on the field, because if you can't pass defend, then you can't be in on certain downs. If you can't run defend, you can't be in. If you can't be in when we're blitzing, if you can't be in when we're trying to run the ball, if we can't be in when we're trying to throw it deep, whatever it is, the more things you can do, the more plays I can have you in on. And if you pitch that to them, then the versatility word may be better to get them to buy in. And it's all about, for Sark, getting them to buy into everything so that they can practice and perform the best on game day.
Yeah, he'd rather use versatility. That's been the buzzword for him in 2024, is versatility, which I've been pushing more versatility, right? More multiplicity. And I'm glad they're moving in that direction. There's also been a lot of talk, Patrick, about the weight of certain players. Sadir Mitchell coming in at 372, and he's being listed at that. I'll say he was listed. I don't know exactly what they are right now, but being listed at 372 at the D tackle position. Savion Redd being listed, I believe, at 240 at one point. Blackshear, the linebacker that came from Alabama, he was listed at 260. Somewhere around there. Sark was asked about those weight gains for these players and whether it's something that was intentional or if it's something to be concerned about. Here is Steve Sarkisian talking about those players.
Probably all three of them a little heavier than we would like. But, you know, we're in March, right? Yeah. And we're not playing a game until, you know, September. I guess it's August 31st this year. And one thing I know, some of that weight will naturally come off through spring practice. The other thing I know, when we start running in June and July in DKR at about 3:30, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, that weight comes off a little easier then too. But again, I'm not overly concerned. I would like that weight to get down for all three of those guys. I think they'll be better players when that weight's down a little bit.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't know. I would have had a follow up about was that part of some type of intentional, was that an intentional weight gain? Was that recommended by the staff that they gain weight? And did they obviously lose track of it? Did they get you know, did basically they get a little bit loose in terms of that recommendation and gain too much weight, or was that not advised or recommended? And that was the players on their own gaining that much weight. Because from what I understand, in elite football programs, organizations, you don't get extreme weight gains like that, 26 pounds on a guy. Or, and I, Sidney Mitchell, I mean, I think he came in at like 360, some 370. So he may just be big and maintaining that, whatever it is. But usually the dietitian, the nutritionist, the strength and conditioning coaches, they work as a collective group and come up with plans for players, well-rounded plans about nutrition, about what they eat and about how many times they eat and about the weight room and how they're going to pack on muscle and how they're going to burn fat, all these things. And so players really aren't allowed, not say allowed, they really don't necessarily have an opportunity for their weight to balloon in that situation because it's being monitored.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. And, you know, and if they're not, you know, taking the recommendations of the dietitian, nutritionist, and strength and conditioning coaches, well, then you got an entirely other, entirely new problem and a bigger problem.
Yeah, I mean, right? I would guess by it was surprising that he didn't say any one of them was, oh no, we're trying to do that. We're trying to put this on, and maybe they put on too much. He just said they're a little over what we want. So I think when you say a little over, especially on Savion Red, then I think that means we were trying to put weight on him. And for whatever reason, either we said, you know, we went to Savion Red and said, eat all you want, and then just make sure to hit the gym, and said, okay, tone back that eat all you want thing. You know, maybe it's not enough protein. Maybe it's, you know, whatever else they're eating. And there could be points where they're going to have to fine tune it. And maybe it was a process of for the next 6 weeks, do this, and then we'll come back and reevaluate. And now they have to reevaluate it now at the beginning of spring. But yeah, it was not the answer that I thought he was going to say at all. Yeah, especially not for all three.
We're supposed to be thinking he's pulling the okie doke on us. That basically Sark is pulling a fast one. That this was intentional, and at least for Savion Red, I think it is intentional. And I do believe right now they're going to fine tune it, refine it, whatever this vision they have for Savion Red is. I think for Blackshire, it also is very intentional, deliberate. And Sark has done this before. I remember when Sark broke out the big O-line package, like the 6 O-line package, the big 11, big 12 package for the first time. He did it early on in the season. And he did it during one of the non-conference games early on in the season. And he said the reason he was like, we were just tinkering with some. Because it was Andre Carrick a couple of years ago. They do it with Andre Carrick. And then they've done it with Malik Ogbo lately. He's been that guy. And he said the reason he was doing it was because, oh, no, we it was tight end depth. Or he had some issues with our tight end depth. And we needed to have him out there. Depth concerns. And I was like, that don't make no damn sense. That's not what you're doing it out there for. You're experimenting with the 6-0 line package, and you just wanted to see if it worked and tweaks and things before you unveil it against Alabama or somebody else. And that's exactly what happened. He unveiled it, and now they use it a lot. They use a Big 11, Big 12 package a lot. I was like, yeah, it wasn't. He just made that up. He just said that because he didn't want the media to necessarily reveal that Texas was working with a 6-0 line pack. And I get it. So I do think there is a little bit of that there with Sark. Sark's a very intelligent coach. I think that weight gain was deliberate. There's a vision for these guys. He just may not want to reveal it, that maybe Rod B is right, that he's going to be his version of Kyle Juszczyk.
Yeah,
a versatile weapon, but also can be a fullback, short yardage power back if you need it.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what I think it is too. Clearly he wanted them to put on weight, because if he didn't, then it seems like it would be more players. If it was, that he'd say, well, this one player is kind of standing out that they weren't supposed to. Mm-hmm. And now it may have been he saw them walk in and said, "That's right. Not what I meant." You know,
that's not what I,
because if you see like Savion Red, he doesn't look that big, but you can see he has a little belly on him right now.
He's got a little punch.
It's not much, but if you're Sark, you go, I don't want to see any belly. I want to see you put on 26 pounds of pure muscle.
Rock it up.
Yeah. And so that could be the issue of when he says, I want him to lose a little bit. It goes, no, you know, you weight gain, you put on the mask. Now it's time to refine it. But I think it is. It's definitely got to be my plan. It has to be.
Yeah, no, I think so too. I like I said, there's no way I think like those guys. They ate themselves into 20 something extra pounds in the offseason. No, that stuff is monitored, and these guys are, you know, disciplined athletes. I just think there's a little bit more to it. But I appreciate Sarkin.
Do you ever watch Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
Yeah.
When Mac put on all the weight in the entire season, they're like, "You're so fat." He's like, "No, I'm just putting on mass." that is what Sark is treating this like.
Yeah, he's like, "That's same getting red." No, just put on mass. I'll put on mass. That's good stuff. Okay, one other clip that I want to play before we get to the break here. About the interior D line, since we're talking about big boys, Sidir Mitchell, he's got to step up, and he's 370 something pounds. Reportedly, he did have to take a lap at practice one time because Kenny Baker, the new D line coach, was a little frustrated with maybe his effort or execution, one of those other things. So he did have to take a lap that was seen by the media. So I'm sure that wasn't a great way to start. But here is Sark talking about the interior D line, and you have to replace Tavondre Sweat, Byron Murphy, first and a second round pick. Well, at least projected to be a first and a second round pick in both of those guys. And think about what you had the year before that. You had Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat in addition to Keandre Coburn and Moro Ojimo. I mean, having back-to-back drafts with two guys, two D linemen drafted the same position in the interior D line is really, really impressive. So here's Sark talking about how they're going to replace those guys who's want to step up for Texas.
You know, I think, you know, we have some probably a little bit more experience than maybe people will want to give us credit for. You know, Alford is a very talented player who has matured from one year to the next to the next. And I think that he's you know, if he continues on the progression that he's on, he's poised to have a great year. I think Vernon Broughton, again, another one of those guys that they gave us a lot of quality reps the last two seasons. And I think now more than ever, they're poised to step into that role. And Tia Savea, I mean, he's played a lot of football at Arizona. So to have that experience of those three guys is helpful. And then we've got some young, talented players. You know, I think Dre Bledsoe is an extremely talented young player who's going into year three now. I think Aaron Bryant is another guy that's going to now start to give us some of those reps that Alfred and Vernon gave us the last couple of years that they can give us. I think a first glance, you know, Alex January is a guy who has been impressive early on in off-season workouts and conditioning and things. And so I think we've got that a really good mix of older veteran players who are ready for their time. Similar to Sweat and similar to Murphy, you know, when Moro and Coburn left, they stepped into that role. And so now it's that next phase, and it's that natural progression of guys moving through the program.
All right, there you go. Sark talking about what is probably for most people the biggest question mark or concern on the team is that interior D line. All right, we come back. We'll come back and we'll get into At the Turn on the side, talk a little golf. We got some great guests coming up. We'll have Charlie Wilson, and also we have Omar Uresti, pro golfer Omar Uresti, lifetime Longhorn, and also Austin Knight, born in the great city of Austin, to talk a little golf with us at the Turns. Coming right back, this is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming right back on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. If time is money, my friends at Apple Leasing are in the business of saving you both. Apple Leasing has the ability to put you in any make or model vehicle that you want. The professionals over at Apple Leasing can help you get the price you want, the payment you want on the car that you want. And all it takes is one phone call or one click on Apple Leasing's website, and you'll get a quote on any make or model vehicle that you want. They can even give you an estimate on the value of your trade-in right over the phone. They have what they call a simple interest easy lease, which allows you to have a lot more flexibility, which is going to give you more possibilities and options to help you find the vehicle that fits you best, but more importantly, the vehicle that fits your budget best. Inflation is through the roof. We all feel it. I mean, it's never been more expensive to buy anything, and that includes an automobile. That's why leasing makes more sense than ever. You're only paying for the part of the car you're actually using. So call Apple Leasing today, 512-346-9977, and let them see how much money they can save you. They get all the same discounts, all the same incentives that the dealers do, except my friends at Apple Leasing, they like to pass those savings on to you, the customer. So give them a call, 512-346-9977, or visit appleleasing.com. That's appleleasing.com.
I'm all right. Nobody but about me. Why you got to give me a fight? Can't you just let it be?
Turn is presented by Callahan's General Store, helping to keep your yard and golf course condition year-round for 45 years. It's always a good day to make it a Callahan's day.
All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. It is time for At the Turn. That's when we bring in a very special guest. First guest is, of course, Charlie Wilson. He's the president, CEO, and general manager of Callahan's General Store, but also a golf enthusiast, and also we have a good time with him on the show, and he comes on and joins us at the Turn Wednesdays in the second segment of the show. Hey, Charlie, how you doing? We appreciate your time.
Good morning, guys. Glad to be with you again this morning.
Charlie, you've talked about how impressive Scottie Scheffler is, and we're going to talk about a lot of different things here on the show because I want to get your thoughts about a little drama that happened at the Players' Championship too. But you've talked about how impressive Scottie Scheffler is. His win at the Players' Championship, which, by the way, first player to go back-to-back at the Players' Championship. It was his 17th top five finish in the last two PGA Tour seasons. No other player has more than nine. My favorite freaky Scheffler stat, because he's got a bunch of them now, is that he has shot under par in all 27 of his rounds played this season on the PGA Tour, the longest streak ever to begin a PGA Tour season, and it ties the longest streak of rounds under par in PGA Tour history. He's only had one double bogey in 2024. Is this the best golf we've seen from a golfer since Tiger Woods in his prime?
It's hard to argue against that, Rod. I mean, this guy is in a zone right now that's like none other. I mean, you're an athlete and you understand when you kind of get into a zone and, you know, you just, everything is clicking for you. Your mind is right. Your mind is at ease. Your body's working right. Nothing hurts. It's all just working together. But what I think is really interesting about what, you know, Scottie Scheffler is doing on the PGA Tour is he's doing it week after week after week. And it is Tiger-esque in that way, in that for whatever reason, you know, all the preparation that he puts into it, he is locked in. And, you know, when he's even in the last year when he was bad, he was good. He just couldn't get the ball in the hole fast enough to win many of the tournaments that he was right there ready to win. And now he's good. And when he's good, he's really good, as we're seeing. And I think there's probably even better in him, in the foreseeable future, if he keeps this going.
Yeah, because his putting has improved and he's gone through a number of different methods trying to improve the putting, and the putting seems to have gotten better, no doubt about it. If that continues to be the case, he's going to be just a nightmare for the rest of the PGA Tour. This is something I thought was interesting, though, because I want to ask you about it because I'm sure there are a lot of unorthodox ways to try to improve your golf game. He actually claims that maybe he's just trying to get an endorsement from Chapstick. But I heard in the him with the media availability, I heard him say that there's an exercise that he uses with his Chapstick, actually, that has helped him improve his putting game. Here is Scottie Scheffler. We actually have the audio here of Scottie Scheffler talking about this after his Players Championship win. But here's Scottie Scheffler claiming that Chapstick actually a big part of the improvement in his putting game.
We noticed earlier this week practice putting routine where you kind of throw your Chapstick and then just putt from there. Wondered if you could shed some insight on where that comes from.
Just doing some speed control. Basically, I'm just hitting towards that piece of Chapstick, hitting all different kinds of putts. And I'm basically trying to close my eyes and judge when the ball is going to be rolling past the Chapstick. It's kind of entertaining too. Sometimes I throw the Chapstick at people when we're out there, depending on if any of my buddies are on the putting green. It's just a good way to kind of just get more engaged into my field, just be more outward with things, you know, not focus so much on what's going on down there. Typically, I would have a coin, but a lot of times when I get out on the practice green, I just forget, and I always just happen to have Chapstick in my pocket. That's pretty much it.
Okay. Charlie, yeah, I know you've probably heard of some very strange, unorthodox methods to improve your golf game. And we are being joined right now by Omar Uresti, pro golfer, legendary lifetime Longhorn, as well as pro golfer and an Austinite too, someone born here in the Austin area. So I could throw it out there to Omar as well. But you guys ever heard of something as unorthodox as just throwing Chapstick and trying to putt to the Chapstick and improving your accuracy that way?
Well, I can say that I've seen a lot of things happen on putting greens that maybe aren't quite orthodox. Omar can probably speak even more to that than I can. But people do all kinds of stuff just to get themselves focused. Some people will throw a dime down, you know, across the green and hit a ball to a dime. I've seen guys flick for cigar smoke on the green and then pull back and start putting toward their cigar ashes. You know, that kind of thing. People do anything to try to get their focus on putting. You know, it's a lot of the putting happens between the ears. It's not so much what happens when you kind of swing the club and try to roll it. So whatever gets you comfortable and focused, I'm sure that people will take all kinds of measures to try to get that done.
Yeah, I'll ask Omar, who's with us right now, Omar Uresti, who's a pro golfer himself and a lifetime Longhorn as well. Omar, thank you for joining us, but we know you got a lot going on too. We know you're rushing to get it done, so we appreciate you. Have you ever heard? First of all, let me ask you about Scottie Scheffler and his game now. But you ever heard of some strange ways to improve your game using Chapstick as a marker for you? I think Omar is still getting set up for us. Let me ask you, Charlie. Let me ask you this: since we're waiting on Omar, and when he gets set up, we'll go to him. We just talk about Scottie Scheffler as the best, male golfer on the planet. Who's the best female golfer on the planet?
Well, you know, you could argue, Korda, just, you know, Nellie Korda is certainly right there, but there are just a number of female players who are there as well. It used to feel like a much more narrow field of women golfers who were leading the way out there, but you got, you know, worldwide a number of players who can just step in from, you know, New Zealand, from here in the States to, Lynn Grant from over in Europe. I mean, there's so many really good players and good swings. And the great thing about ladies golf, I think professional golf is, at least to me, is that it's relatable in so much as that they're not pounding it out there 300. Well, some can, but they're not pounding it out there 350 yards. They're hitting kind of in the same range, at least what I would strive for as a male amateur golfer right now. And so I think the women's game is very relatable. The women's professional game, and they've done a really good job of marketing it. I think they're getting a lot more money into their game, and I think it's a pretty engaging product if you watch it on TV.
Yeah, and I actually heard you talk about this before. You want to get an LPGA tour event here in Austin.
Well, Onion Creek Yeah, Onion Creek used to have one here back in the 90s in Austin. And we've seen women's professional golf come and go through this market at various levels, either on the Futures Tour as well as LPGA Tour. And I think, you know, given the size of our market here in Austin, it would behoove this market to try to get a women's tour event here or a championship event here, because we have the golf courses that would suit the women's game really, really well here. And I think there's a market that's kind of hungry for that here in Austin, with the number of women who play golf here in the Austin area, as well as just the number of everybody who junior golf, everybody who is interested in aspiring to be a professional golfer, or at least learn something from professional golf. And as I said before, I think women's golf is very relatable to almost all golfers, with the exception of maybe these guys on the tour who hit it way out there and play a game at another level that hardly any of us except Omar can relate to.
And I think Omar is joining us right now. Omar, how you doing?
I'm doing good, thanks. Doing good.
And thank you for joining, because I know you were running around busy and you're joining us on the fly, so we appreciate that. First of all, let me get your thoughts about Scottie Scheffler. Is he playing the best golf since Tiger Woods in his prime? What are your thoughts?
Well, he seems to be, that's for sure. You know, we'll see how long it can last. Hopefully it can last quite a while like Tiger's, but you know, Tiger was putting up some really big numbers and winning by some big margins. So we'll see what, you know, he is playing great golf. I'll give him that. It looks like his putting's come around, and, you know, that hole out, I guess, yes, on Sunday helped a lot. So, you know, you need little things like that. But, yeah, he's playing some of the best golf I think he has in quite a while.
Hey, I want to ask you, Omar, about some drama at the Players' Championship, actually. Apparently, there was some drama in the group with Rory McIlroy, Jordan Spieth, and Victor Hovland about the ball drop and whether a shot. And I actually didn't even know. I learned some rules about golf in here. And I would love for you to break it down kind of in layman's terms, what the controversy and the drama was all about between those guys and how everything went down. Are you aware of the drama that I'm referring to?
Yes. I got the gist of it. I watched a couple of seconds of it and read a little bit about it. And yeah, the biggest thing is basically they were just trying to figure out where the ball crossed. And it looked like Rory had it, you know, a little bit further up than the other guys had it crossing. And you know, obviously I guess Jordan and Victor seemed to think that it was, you know, a good maybe 50 yards shorter where maybe he ended up dropping. You know, but those kind of angles are really tough to say. And it, you know, if you know, I've had situations like that or been part of situations like that where you sometimes want to give them the benefit of the doubt, but if you are paying attention and you do watch the ball the whole way and you have a good idea, I usually speak up right away saying, hey, I think it crossed right here, instead of them speaking first, to handle the situation a little quicker and a little more manageable. That way they can't quite, you know, get their say in right away, and then they start thinking, oh, well, maybe it did cross back here, instead of them saying, no, it crossed up here right away, you know, and going from there. So it's a tough situation. It's you know, that you just, it's hard to tell in situations like that.
Hey, Omar, who has the ultimate authority? Are we just going off the majority of the group, who, if it's two against one, or do the officials come in, can they it break up any dispute and make the official call? Like, or is that why they call it the gentleman's game? Because the gentleman got to figure it out?
Exactly. I think the gentleman has to figure it out. And yeah, it's basically the majority of the group, including, I guess it sounded like one little article I was reading that the caddies, you know, or one of the caddies spoke up as well. So, but yeah, it's mainly amongst the group and you know, if there's spotters up there, which in this case there was not, because the spotters would be in view, then or on the line of the shot, you know, you can ask the spotters. But in this instance, it just his word against theirs, and hopefully they can come up with an amicable decision.
Yeah, no, it's good stuff. I'm glad we got an insider like yourself, pro golfer, who can kind of break it down for us. Hey, gentlemen, we appreciate time. Before we get out of here, Charlie, I always got to get some tips, man, on how to take care of my yard. You gave me some great tips about the pre-merge. It's already down. The yard looks better. What do folks need to be doing out there so they can have their golf course type of lawn out there and they can get all their tips and resources from Callahan's? We know that.
So we teased this up a little bit last week of getting that weed and feed out there, because you got a combination of both of the grass coming up now as well as those weeds. So get that down, if you would, here in the next week or two, so you can knock out those weeds and keep them from germinating. The other thing is grub worms are going to start coming to the top, and you're going to start seeing some animals digging around in your yards if you got grub worms. To keep that from happening, you need to put some cedar granules down in your yard. So grub worms bring the armadillos, bring the skunks, and bring all those things that you really don't want dug up in your yard. It doesn't look good, and it's probably not real good for the grass, because they eat the roots and kind of knock out your grass. So get rid of those grub worms. Grub worms become June bugs, and you know if you start seeing June bugs, then you got grub worms. Okay, so put some of that nitrophos cedar granules down, and then, you know, get your gardens ready as well. Now it's time to start putting down your tomatoes. We have tomato seedling plants at Callahan's, as well as peppers and melons like cucumbers, watermelon, cantaloupes, all those kinds of things. It's the growing time of year. Come on out. It's also rodeo season, so you can still get your rodeo gear before that finishes up this weekend. And Saturday at noon, we will even have some free live music at Callahan's and kind of help celebrate some of that rodeo. Pauline Reese, she's a wonderful performer. She's recorded with Willie Nelson in the past. She'll be at Callahan's at 12 o'clock on Saturday. Come on out and see us.
And Callahan's has it all. That's why it's a beautiful thing. You're going out there, take the kids out there. They'll have animals and stuff. You can buy your Western wear and get stuff for the yard. I love that. So it's an experience over there at Callahan's General Store. Gentlemen, thank you so much. Appreciate you, Charlie Wilson. Thank you so much, Omar Uresti. Legendary lifetime Longhorn, also Austin Knight, born and raised and pro golfer, one of my favorites, actually. Thank you, guys. We appreciate the time.
Enjoyed
thank
it.
Thank you.
All right, that is At the Turn, courtesy of Callahan's General Store. That is Omar Uresti and Charlie Wilson. We appreciate their time. All right, we come back. We'll go off the record. There may be a developing story in the music industry that could set the music world. It could really turn it upside down. I mean, if this is indeed true. We'll talk about that on the other side when we go into a little off the record. All of that and more when we return right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Love One, Rod Davis, right here on the Horn.
At the Turn is presented by Callahan's General Store, helping to keep your yard in golf course condition year-round for 45 years. It's always a good day to make it a Callahan's day.
Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn, Rod Babers here. Austin, traffic can be a problem. We all know that. But the reason for the traffic is because Austin is such a great city. People keep moving to this city. And yeah, of course, that makes the traffic even worse because everybody's got to get where they're going. But it's one of the fastest growing cities in America. And as that city continues to grow and thrive, well, so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482. And many of the iconic landmarks that you're driving by right now, actually, while you're sitting in traffic, actually were built and crafted and created by these skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local Union 482, like the Pennybacker Bridge and DKR Stadium. And they have another big project happening right here in Central Texas, and they need your help. As a matter of fact, they're hiring over 3,000 people for this project, offering competitive wages, competitive benefits. They're also offering a pension plan, even offering training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program. So if you're looking for an exciting employment opportunity, or maybe you want a refreshing career change, maybe you want a new challenge, maybe you want to feel valued by your employer, you can become a valued member of this prestigious organization, Ironworkers Local 482. And right now, it's a great time for you to do it. You got a lot of different opportunities. And as I said, they're offering competitive wages and competitive benefits. So become a member of Ironworkers Local 482 today. All you got to do is go online and you can inquire about all the different positions and see all the details about all the different benefits at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time for a little off the record. We just got one story that we'll get into here because I know we don't have a ton of time. We're up against it. If we got time, we'll get to that other story too. But it was reported earlier this week that Beyonce is coming out with a new album. It is going to be heavily influenced by country because she has her country hits, or a couple of, at least one of those is a country hit, Texas Hold'em, which I'm sure a lot of you out there already heard that song, and 16 Carriages. And she has now confirmed that she's going to have a forthcoming album coming out. Cowboy Carter is going to be the name. She says it's a Beyonce album, but it will be influenced by country. And there's talk it's going to be with a lot of different collabos from the country realm and beyond. And there is a fan group, a fan base, I should say, that have been speculating that their favorite artist is going to collab with Beyonce. And that is the Swifties. The Swifties out there have kind of been putting together, I don't know, some of their clues, all right, and doing their own, you know, research. And they believe that on this new Beyonce album, Cowboy Carter, that one of the artists she's going to team up with is Taylor Swift. And if that happens, then you got the Beehive and the Swifties together. It's going to be crazy. So that might turn the music world upside down, Patrick. That would be wild. Would you be interested in a Taylor Swift, or at least a Beyonce Taylor Swift collabo?
Honestly, no, I couldn't care less.
But country collabo,
yeah,
too.
Could not care less. That's a bunch of things I don't care about. But it'll be huge. I'm sure I'll hear it a million and a half times. But
you're going
to
hear it.
Yeah, I'll hear it whether I want to or not. But no, I personally, I don't really listen to much Beyonce or Taylor Swift or country music. So none of that. No, I know it's big news. It is big news. Yeah. I work in the music industry. That's why I work with bands that I like, and I try and find music that I enjoy. Look, I've always been of the opinion that music is a beautiful thing, and if you're able to get something out of it and it makes you feel something, then that's awesome. Whatever it is, we don't have to like the same music. But if you're somebody who's the people who are like, I don't like music, that blows my mind. But if you like whatever you like, if it moves you and you feel something when you hear it, that's awesome. So for everybody who loves that stuff and gets into it, love it, awesome, have fun time. But no, I will not be spinning that on my apps.
No, my wife loves Beyonce. She has been described as a lesbian, that she would be lesbian, but only for Beyonce. And my daughter was born to Beyonce. We had a playlist going, and she came out, boom. Beyonce was on. It was actually, I think the song was called All Night. It was on. Beyonce, it was crazy. It was like the fourth or fifth song. It was Beyonce. Boom. So daughter born to Beyonce. So yeah, I got a special relationship with Beyonce in that regard. And, you know, down in H-Town, I'd say from the same city, I know a couple of guys that dated Beyonce. You know what I mean? Down in H-Town, like before she was Beyonce.
Yeah, of course.
When she, you know what I mean? Back in the day. So it's interesting that, the Beehive and all that. I listen to Beyonce. I like Beyonce. I don't listen to Taylor Swift, but I respect her. I respect her. All right. I respect that what she's done. And I know she makes great music. Like you said, it just ain't for me.
Yeah.
It just ain't safe for me. Yeah. And we're raising our daughter with, I don't know how you raise kids without a lot of music. I mean, Bath Time is a different artist every day for Bath Time.
Yeah.
Every night. So we got to choose a different artist. And hell, and she's 5 months old, so we've already run through the gamut. We need more suggestions. And maybe, you know what? Taylor Swift is probably going to be one of the next suggestions. We ain't played Taylor Swift for. We've been here for 5 months, ain't played Taylor Swift. So that's a big part of it. And then when we do like tummy time and all this stuff, you got to have music in the background. We're not letting her watch TV yet or anything like that. So you got to have music in the background. And the right type of music is key. And strangely enough, my daughter's in a really good mood when we play piano cocktail jazz.
Piano cocktail jazz.
I can't explain it. I don't know what the hell it is. It calms her. Piano cocktail jazz. She freaking loves it.
All right. Try some Booker T and the MGs, Green Onions. Babies love green onions. Yeah, it's great.
Okay, there you go. I'll try it. Whatever soothes the beast, hey, I'm all about it. No question. All right, there you go. A little off the record. All right, we come back. We'll get into some of the big headlines of the day. Texas men's basketball. We know their opponent, Colorado State. My man Patrick will give you a little quick rundown about that. We got another Horn headlines coming up, and then we're going to play sound from Steve Sarkisian talking about spring practice once again. A couple of news notes and nuggets from the NFL, especially for Cowboys fans. We'll dive into that too, and we got a rant of the day. And a set list ATX for my man Nick Shuley coming up too. So don't miss that. All that and more right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming back on the Horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers. You can hit us up via Twitter. It's Patrick Davis, but Patrick Davis, I'm at Rod Babers in the Twitterverse. We got a lot to get into here in this hour. It is a One Artist Wednesday. That's when Patrick, the Idealionaire, he decides to go deep, deep, deep down the catalog of one artist. And then that one artist, depending on the jams that he chooses, trying to keep the energy and vibe real good on the show. He plays that, all those sounds. They're not necessarily all the biggest hits. But he chooses all the songs from that one artist on a One Artist Wednesday. And today it is who some people call the king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley. There you go. That's your king of rock and roll. I'm Elvis Presley fan. I just don't think he's the king of
rock. I like that.
And roll.
That's your king. That's your king. Ain't mine. Your king. Ain't mine, but it's yours.
It's not my king of rock and roll, but you know, it's I get it. Okay. Also, there's a big fat poll of the day that was up. You can go check that out. The text line 512-447-3776. Patrick, give the folks the big fat poll of the day.
Who is your favorite underdog team of all time? We did the player yesterday. We did the favorite underdog team of all time as we are as we're getting into Cinderella season. Or March Madness.
You know how I feel about Cinderella. I think she's a gold-digging skank. I know. I understand why everybody loves the Cinderella story during March Madness. I'm sure a couple of those could be March Madness teams that pulled off those big upsets. Speaking of, because didn't Virginia lose like to a
16 seed?
16 seed.
And they won the tournament the next
2018?
Year. 2018. They 2018? Won, and they won 2019. Yeah. They won the tournament in 2019. Which is what people think because Purdue lost to a 16 seed last year, that Purdue could do the same thing this year. That Purdue it falls into that statistical category.
Good point on that one. We'll talk about Virginia because Virginia lost to Colorado State. That's how we found out who the Longhorns will play. The men are going to play in the first round of the NCAA tournament. So we'll get into that. That was an ugly first half of basketball for Virginia. I mean,
it was ugly for both teams. It was just ugly.
It was. Yeah, but Virginia, it was just
14 points. They scored 14 points. That's all you'd say. They scored 14 points in the first half.
14 points. Yeah, like I said, UGLY. So actually, that's why you were right. You said you'd rather them play Virginia because Virginia, they're not going to be able to go on some epic offensive run and put Texas in a hole. You said they're not capable of it. I'll give my man Patrick credit. You're right. They didn't look like they were capable of doing that.
Let's put it this way. They proved what I was felt before, which is they were there solely on name. That if they were not Virginia, that resume would not have got them in. Because they're Virginia, because they'd won it in 2019, because that Tony Bennett's still the coach, they said maybe he'll pull out some magic, but there was no magic. They're rebuilding this year. They basically, instead of trying to get a bunch of transfers, went ahead and said, we're going to play our younger guys more, which meant they didn't have the talent. They shouldn't have really been in there. You maybe could have given that to another team that would have played a better game. But that's why I wanted to play Virginia, because I knew all of those things.
Yeah. And you said you thought, you know, Colorado State could present some problems to Texas, but you're confident in Texas matchup wise. Matching up very well against this Colorado State team.
Yeah, I mean, they're just not an overly talented team. There's no one on the team that really, really scares you as somebody who could come in and just dominate Texas. So I think that overall, you're still not super worried. This is a Texas don't beat Texas game.
Exactly.
You just can't allow them to do whatever they want to. You have to still play defense. You have to rebound. You can't turn the ball over a bunch of times. You can't let them force you into or let them trick you into just thinking that shooting threes all game is the right way to win, because for Texas, they have not put on 40 minutes of decent three-point shooting the entire season, really. They've had halves of it, but not 40 minutes. So if they play zone and back off you a little bit, they're doing that on purpose to make you shoot threes because they don't trust you're going to hit them. So if you're Texas, just understand, even if they do that, get the ball inside to Dylan Dessou, let him go to work. Caden Shedrick should be able to go to work on these guys. We saw him non-conference have good games against opponents that were not as talented as some of the Big 12 opponents inside. He should be able to go to work inside. Dylan Mitchell is taller, faster, stronger, bigger than most of these guys. He should be able to get to the paint and get some dunks. And Tyrese Hunter, if he can drive the bucket and get in the free throw trouble, it opens everything up, and they should be able to get this win. and then they can move on and focus on Tennessee. But you got to play your game first. You cannot look past it, which I think one of the bigger issues you worry about with Texas.
Yeah, it would have to be a confluence of bad, honestly, a bad basketball, of a lot of different factors working against Texas, them beating themselves. Dessou could get Dessou's in foul trouble. That's concerning, yep. But that's on top of if Texas is settling, like you said, for too many three-pointers, that could be an issue. Those really long streaks where they go without scoring, that could come back to haunt them. But I don't think that there'll be a combination of those things in this matchup versus Colorado State that'll really limit Texas. I think Texas actually wins it. I'm not going to say comfortably, but I'm confident, and I'm confident because of some of the breakdown from my man Patrick. All right, Patrick also will give us the Horn headlines here coming up here momentarily, and after that we'll get into Setlist ATX. Got my man Nick Shuley on the scene. We're gonna ask him about Texas spring football also, and also about Texas men's basketball too. But he also will break down the best venues and some of the top musical acts that'll be in town, and the places that you probably need to put on your schedule. We'll do that coming up with Setlist ATX, but first I set the Horn headlines, get you informed and educated on all the big stories of the day.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball rallied late and walked off the game in 10 innings against Air Force last night. Jalen Flores hit a two-run home run in the ninth to tie the game, and then D. Kennedy hit a shot to center field with the bases loaded in the 10th to win the game 6-5. Texas will have a quick turnaround as they face Air Force again this afternoon at 4. Two more teams earned their ticket to the Field of 64 in the NCAA men's tournament last night, as Wagner withstood a late run by Howard to advance, and Colorado State had no problem with Virginia winning 67-42. The Rams held Virginia to this 25% shooting on the game and will now focus their attention on the Texas Longhorns, who they will face on Thursday. In the NBA, the Rockets kept their playing hopes alive with a 137-114 win over the Wizards, led by Jalen Green with 42 points. Houston now sits just 2.5 games back of the 10 seed. And the two other Texas teams were in action against each other on Tuesday as the Mavericks held on to beat the Spurs 113-107 behind Kyrie Irving's 28 points and another triple-double from Luka Doncic. In the world of baseball, MLB had a soft opening playing in Seoul, South Korea. The Dodgers beat the Padres 5-2 this morning. They will play one more game tomorrow before the regular season kicks off next week. That is your Horn headlines.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the Horn headlines. We appreciate that. Before we get into some of the other sports stories, let's bring in my man Nick Shuley for Setlist ATX. We appreciate Nick and all of his time. Nick, you've been a busy man, dude. I know you've been a busy man. Didn't join us next week, but we appreciate Higgs coming in. He did a great job for you. How you been, man? You've been Have you taken some time for yourself? Have you had any downtime at all with South by Southwest going on, and then you got your job and you got your 13 other things you're doing?
Yeah, Patrick and I were talking about this. I'm like, man, it is it's nonstop. Like last week was just constant things everywhere, different people in town. You know, everyone in the industry comes in, so it's a great week to get a lot of things done. But I was also saying I was remiss in that I was like, what were my favorite artists I saw? But it was more running around to like meet up with people. There were artists playing in the background. Like I didn't have as much chance to sit there and watch what I wanted. But I was complaining also about all my friends in town who were like, come meet me here. Come meet me here. I'm like, can we just do that next week? Because well, we got enough going on. We're here all the time. I see you every day.
Serious. I see you all the time. I'm actually trying to go to this once in a lifetime event, possibly here in South by Southwest. I feel you on that. We appreciate the time, man. We appreciate you actually joining us. But first, before we get started with the Setlist ATX, let me get your thoughts about Texas basketball, Texas men's basketball. The women, listen, there's a reason we're not talking about the women as much. The ladies got a one seed. They are going to destroy Drexel. It's going to be bad. So that's the reason we're not breaking that down. It's just not entertaining. When the ladies advance and they actually have to play somebody that's going to give them like a competitive game, we'll break down the ladies a little bit too. Trust me on that. But we're talking about the men because now we know who they're going to play. They're going to play Colorado State. It's who my man Patrick. He thought that Virginia would be an easier matchup, a more favorable matchup for Texas. After watching last night, I think we all agree it's going to be hard to argue with that. So what are your thoughts about Texas men's basketball going up against Colorado State in their first-round matchup in the tourney?
Man, I was bummed because I knew Caden Shedrick probably had all the notes. He's got everything on Tony Bennett, you know, so we would have had to eat the full game plan. He's like, here's what they're going to do. These are the five sets they're going to run. Which, by the way, huge Tony Bennett fan, but this Virginia team was not, they were not supposed to be there. And I agree a lot with what Patrick said. It's a game of you can't beat yourself. And, you know, as long as they don't have any crazy performances and we don't rely too much on the three, I think we'll be all right. I painfully watched as much of that game as I could. And I was flipping between that and the Longhorn baseball game. And I ended up sticking more on the Longhorn baseball game because I was like, this is hard to watch. 14 points and a half is, oof, that's some, you know, yeah. That was like the eighth grade basketball team I coached. So it was
rough. Yeah. No, they can score more than 14 and a half.
The craziest stat in that game is that I think Virginia had four turnovers.
No way.
That is the craziest stat to me. To score 14 points and they had three turnovers in the first half. So they were not turning it over.
They were efficient, getting good shots, just can't make shots.
Yeah, and I mean, they weren't all good shots either, but because they would hold the ball. We said the first possession of the game was a shot clock violation. Not a great sign.
How the hell does that happen?
I mean, it was like, a good precursor.
Have a set play already, man. How does that even happen? That's crazy. Now I wish we were playing Virginia, though. Now I wish I wish badly that Texas was playing Virginia. But they will play Colorado State coming up in the first tournament game. We'll break that down a little bit more tomorrow, obviously, in more detail. But let's get to Setlist ATX while we have you here, Nick, because you, like my man Patrick, a music aficionado and a music enthusiast, and you give people all the details on where the best acts are in town, at least in your opinion, who some of the best acts are in town. So let's start up with the Setlist ATX right now.
Yeah, I call this the hangover week. It's the week after South by where, you know, you get some good ones coming through, but so many people were here the week before. So it's, you know, there's always good stuff happening locally. So I try to pull more local for this one. I know we usually do more roadshow type thing, but there's some good stuff happening. So tonight we've got the Ransom Brothers, who I really like. I kind of talk about them every week, but they're a good little up and coming alt country band from Austin, and they're playing the Saxon Pub. And then 90s rockers, famous for the teenage dirtbag song Wheatus, will be here. Who I actually really liked their record back in the day. I'm gonna say it, like they were fun. I saw that.
Your teenage dirtbag phase?
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Yeah, when I was watching all my teen movies in the 90s, like yeah, I dug them, man. It was the soundtrack to the moment, you know. Then let's see. Tomorrow night we got Josh Rouse, who's one of my favorite artists. He's just a good singer songwriter. He'll be playing 310 at ACL Live. Corey Morrow, Texas country legend, will be over at the O4 Center, which I always preach this. If you haven't been to the O4 Center, it's an awesome venue that has amazing sound. It's an old church. You get to sit in pews. The sound is phenomenal in there, and especially for artists doing more kind of acoustic turn down sets, it's a great spot. And then over at the Scoot Inn, it will be the Last Dinner Party, who I actually didn't know, but they're a female indie rock band, and they'll be playing out there.
Okay.
And then Friday, we got a bunch of stuff. So Tyler Ramsey will be bringing his spacey indie rock to the Parish show. I'm very excited about as a little punk kid. The punk legends, the Descendants with the Circle Jerks and the Adolescents will be over at Stubbs. So you'll see a lot of old people dressed in black that probably look a lot like me wearing their Vans. We'll be over there at Stubbs on Friday. And then a new school R&B artist who I really, really like, a kid named Aaron Ray, and it's spelled A-R-I-N, will be over at Empire Control Room. And then Bayonne brings his electro pop to the O4 Center. And then David Spade, the comedian, over at the Paramount Theater, which I have a feeling will be pretty interesting.
Wow.
He's pretty funny. And then the one we'll have a giveaway for later, this kid, Brendan Walter, who I really like. He's kind of a new wave country singer-songwriter. He'll be at the Saxon Pub. And then Jonathan Tyler and his bluesy country rock will be at the Continental Club. And then two nights, Friday and Saturday at Green Hall, you have Stephenville's own Giovanni and the Hired Guns, who are, you know, a lot of people's pick to be kind of the next big Texas kind of country band to come up. They'll be there Friday, Saturday. And then a very interesting band, not my thing, but the Dresden Dolls will be at Mohawk. And if you haven't heard them, it sounds like the soundtrack to like a Transylvanian vampire movie mixed with like piano rock. So very interesting. They'll be at Mohawk, but they have a big following. So they'll be out there. And then over at Stubbs, a dance group who I really like. It's kind of hip hop dance music. Hippie Sabotage will be playing there.
Love the name. Yeah, they're, great name.
Oh, they're great too. And then another big 90s band, the Squirrel Nut Zippers, for you swing fans, will be at the Paramount, which I'm actually very interested to see how a seated show at the Paramount what the swing band will be. I have a feeling we'll see a lot of older folks dancing in the aisles. Yeah, which would be cool. And then another really good smaller Austin country band, Harvest Thieves, will be at White Horse. I really like them. Another Texas country music artist who has a big following, Stoney LaRue, will be at Hotspot out in Cedar Park. And then Legendary Austinite Marsha Ball is having her 75th birthday at the State Theater right there by the Paramount. And she's got a ton of guests, and that'll be kind of a who's who of Austin, in my opinion, with Delbert McClinton, Ruthie Foster, Shelly King, and just tons more will be out there. That'll be a cool one for all you Austin folks. And then Sunday, I just heard the ad here 30 minutes ago, but the Imagine Muni event with the Sleep at the Wheel, Gary P. Nunn, and Larry Gatlin will be over at ACL Live. And then another punk legend, Black Flag, will be at Come and Take It Live. I think Henry Rollins is still back in them. I'm not positive. That's really the reason you go see Black Flag. But I believe he'll be there. That's at Come and Take It over there by the back room, or what used to be the back room, what is now Emo's. Actually, by the way, there is a documentary coming out about the back room. I just heard about it. I'm so excited.
Yeah,
about
I got
that.
Some friends who were in it.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, so it should be a cool thing. Yeah. Well, because I know all those guys that used to go back to the back room. And the back room, if you didn't know about the back room, the thing you would know is there's two ways. Either you used to go there and it was crazy, or you've seen the music videos on Austin Music Network and you could always tell because there was a pole directly in the middle of the stage.
In your sight line, in
like,
the middle.
Like right where you would put the mic for the lead singer, there's a pole. And so every band you could tell would play there, but they had everybody back in the day. Like Red Hot Chili Peppers started out there. There was a story of, I believe it was Two Live Crew came in, played, and then robbed them afterwards.
I mean, did you ever go, Patrick? Yes. Were you around? Yeah. Okay. I wonder if Patrick and I were at some of the same shows back in the day. That's funny to think about. But my favorite backroom story, I'll hurry. But we had a band when I worked for Sony as a street rep, called Finger Tight, and they were playing there. They were opening for someone, and they were these like California kids. They were super pretty little rocker kids, and the lead singer comes back to the merch table from going to the bathroom, and he's crying, and like he was like gothed out, you know, he's got his hair and makeup, all this stuff, and he's bawling, and we're like, Scott, what's wrong, dude? And he's like, bro, I just got mugged in the bathroom. And that to me is a great backroom story. You could go left to the biker bar, or you could go right to the music venue.
And you did not hang out in the parking lot.
Yeah, you didn't hang out in the parking lot. And for me at my age, you didn't hang out at the bar either. So you just timed it perfectly to get a parking spot, get right in there. And, you know, it was anyway, I digress.
Wow.
But yeah, great place. That's funny. And then let's see, Sunday, Mike Dowdy, another big 90s band, Soul Coughing. The lead singer Soul Coughing will be at 310 at ACL Live. And then Monday, a really cool pop artist, Matt Hansen, will be at 310. And then the one I was really excited about, which I just found out got canceled, was Busta Rhymes was supposed to be at Stubbs on Tuesday, I would have loved to have seen Busta there. I saw him once before with Bubba Sparks. That was a cool show. But anyway.
Yeah.
So,
man, Busta Rhymes' rapping style, rapping period doesn't necessarily age well on guys who would get older and they're in their 50s rapping. But Busta Rhymes' rapping style in his older age would be interesting to see.
Yeah, he can still go. I bet he still puts on a good show. And he's got so many hits too. It's one of those.
No, he does. He got a bunch of them. But
sadly, we will. Hopefully that one gets rescheduled. I just found out that got canceled. So I was very sad. I was excited to talk about that one.
Yeah, Nick was gonna be in the audience, man.
No, I would have
going hard at the Busta Rhymes show. All right. You got a ticket giveaway for the people out there as well, Nick, and we appreciate that.
Yeah, Brendan Walter over at Saxon Pub on Friday. We're going to give away a couple guest list spots for that. Joe Abels and the good folks at Saxon have contributed those.
So I'll tell you what, let's go on the text line 512-447-3776. If you want to win those tickets, text in the word set list. And we will, and anybody who texts that in, we'll pick one of the winners for random from there, and we'll contact you on the text line to get you those tickets.
512-447-3776, number to the text line. Nick, when was the last vacation you had?
Man, they kind of lumped together with work. I think, if you could call it that, it was probably a Disney trip with all my nieces and nephews, but I'm not sure that's a vacation because
we
all had shifts. So, man, I honestly don't remember. I just blend it with work, you know? No separation.
I was like, what if Nick took like 3-4 days and didn't do any work, no special projects, just chilled, kicked it, went and watched music, sat by the beach or something. It's been a long time. Nick, you need to schedule that, brother.
I know I do. Done. Well, at least you on do. That Disney trip, it rained so hard on the Jungle Cruise that my phone fried. And so I didn't have a phone for the rest of the trip. So I did get a semi-vacation there. Thanks, Jungle Cruise in Florida.
How old were your nephew, your nieces and nephews?
Oh, man, there were six of them now, but there were five at the time. So it was like, you talk about each day someone had their breakdown. It was pretty great.
That is no vacation, brother. That is not a vacation.
I had fun, man. It was fun. But yeah, I did have my day too where I was like, don't talk to me. Don't look at me. Don't even come near me. My goth Disney.
I feel that. No, okay, real quick, because you've been to Disney. Have you heard about this phenomenon of Disney adults who don't have kids with them? They're at the Disney park just enjoying the experience of Disney stuff. Dude, no kids everywhere. With them at all. It's just, yes, right? This is a thing?
Well, when I flew to the national championship, we got routed through Orlando because that was the only flight we could get that wasn't $1 million, and or not to the national championship, to the playoff game in New Orleans. And I sat there and watched people come out in the airport off the plane, and there were not as many kids as I expected. It was lots of people, and we saw lots of tattoos, like tons of like Mickey Mouse, like full Goofy, all that stuff. And I mean, props, dude. I'm a Disney fan. I like it. Probably not like that level. I'd probably bring my nieces and nephews, but yeah, it is definitely a thing. And I mean, we're talking. I mean, maybe just as many of those. That's probably aggressive, but there are a lot of people that just go there and hang.
Like, I understand that more than bringing a kid under 3 or 4. Yeah. There's no memories. Yeah. They're not going to remember a second of this trip. That is a lot of money to spend on something that is done the second you walk out.
That's for you. If that, those are the parents being like, this kid's my excuse to go to Disney.
Yeah, that's the same thing. You just got to carry around something that's going to scream.
That's true. Great point. It's their excuse to go, because you're right. They're not going to remember that. That's way too much bread for a kid that small. That's okay. I know.
So I have
people that, yes, I just had my wife's sister. They just came back this past, I think they went like a month ago or something like that. And yeah, man, they were like, no, you'd be surprised how many adults, they just go and they want to experience the same stuff as the kids. They want to meet all the characters. I was like, wow, I didn't know that was a thing. It is a thing.
I think it's our generation. I think we grew up in that. And so like, I think that people still want to do it. And I mean, look, I'll probably end up being one of those someday. So
yeah,
Nick's not hating on them too much. Yeah, he's like, yeah, like
I gotta be careful. I gotta hedge my bets here.
I mean, in reality, I've gone to amusement parks. You go as an adult without kids, you don't need those to just be like, oh, go ride some roller coasters and stuff. You
that's
don't
true.
Need a kid
so maybe
for that.
Just ride
I'm not trying to meet Mickey.
Dress up.
I'm trying to ride rides.
That's like cosplay kind of. They like dress up too.
Oh, yeah.
Like the characters. And I think it's the Star Wars group is what I'm hearing mostly. It's like, no, the Star Wars adults, they're serious
Star
about
Wars,
it.
Star Wars, Harry like, Potter's adults.
Yeah.
Think
yeah.
Bad.
There you go.
See, I'm not going to hate too much on these either because I might fall in some of those brackets. So, you know, it is what it is.
I'm not hating.
It's just an observation. I didn't know that was a thing. Yeah, I didn't know it was a thing, and now I know. All right, Nick, we appreciate the time, brother. We know you got to go. You got a lot of stuff to do. Thank you very much, man. Great job with Setlist ATX, as always.
Appreciate y'all. Thanks, guys.
And text line's open for that. We'll pull the winners here at 10 o'clock. 512-447-3776. Text the word Setlist to win tickets to Brendan Walter at Saxon on Friday. Word Setlist.
Thanks, Nick Shuley. Yeah, Nick Shuley is awesome. And I don't know. My man Patrick will handle that. Hopefully, good luck to you guys. Hopefully, you win those tickets. We come back. We'll get into Rod's rant of the day. We'll also play some of that sound from Steve Sarkisian, and we'll go over to Mel Kiper and the Daniel Jeremiah latest mock drafts. All that and more right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming right back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Pro Day happening today on the 40 Acres as well. So we talked a lot of Texas spring ball and heard from Steve Sarkisian. We'll hear from him again coming up in this segment. But it's Texas Pro Day is big. You got a lot of guys who are going to be doing different drills and, you know, NFL scouts, NFL executives. You could have some couple of GMs and coaches there as well. They'll be there to watch these guys perform the drills, a lot of the drills that they didn't do at the combine. Now, some of these guys, if they impressed at the combine and they performed at a really high level at the combine, they won't do anything except for probably, you know, A.D. Mitchell and Xavier Worthy will run routes there at the pro day. Maybe there'll be some guys that do drills. Maybe Byron Murphy will do some drills. Maybe Tavondre Sweat will do some drills. But pretty much those guys did most of the relevant testing at the combine, so they won't test at pro day. I think Jalen Ford will probably do a lot of testing at pro day because he only did the broad jump and the vertical at the combine. I'm not sure if he wants that to stand as his testing measurements. There's also Jay Witt, who didn't do anything at the combine because he was dealing with an injury, and he's been dealing with an injury since the season ended, which is why he didn't participate in the Senior Bowl. So the NFL scouts, all they know of Jay Witt is, oh, man, he was injured in the Senior Bowl when I got a chance to meet him. I met him and talked to him at the combine, but he didn't perform and didn't play at the Senior Bowl and didn't perform any of the drills at the combine. And that probably is for a lot of coaches. I'm sure he's really low down on their priority list of prospects, and he's got to have a big day. So he's going to be the busiest guy at the pro day. He's got to test. He's going to have to do all the drills they want him to do. And he's got to go run routes as a wide receiver. So he's got the busiest day, but the player with the most to gain at the pro day is definitely Quinn Ewers. I was looking on my timeline here on X. I still call it Twitter, which makes me feel old because I'm referring to an app or a new device or technology by the wrong terminology. So that's what old people do. So I'm going to start trying to call it X. Then I feel stupid calling it X.
I know.
Because there was no need for them to change it. But anyway,
can you meet in the middle ground and call it the X? So if you got the X, then you're still old in the X. I'm on the X. I think that makes sense.
Yes, or when somebody calls, old person calls TikTok tic-tac.
Yes.
It's like, no, it's not tic-tac-toe. No, that's not. No, it's not a modern tic-tac-toe. It's TikTok. Okay, you know, we'll forget about it. But anyway, I was looking on my timeline on the X app, and I saw NFL reporters, Mike Garofalo, James Palmer from the NFL, from NFL Network, and you saw these in Pro Football Talk. They all had tweets and stories referencing Quinn Ewers throwing at Texas Pro Day. All right. And these are NFL reporters, because it is, in my opinion, the first chance for Quinn Ewers to actually make a first impression. And you won't get a second chance at that on some of these NFL scouts, some of these NFL execs, some of these NFL coaches, maybe even some NFL GMs. Who's going to ever be out there at the Texas Pro Day, which they're going to be a lot of, you know, a lot of teams represented, because there are 11 guys that were invited to the combine. So for Quinn Ewers, it's going to be so important that, you know, he's going to look great when he throws. He's going to be throwing in, you know, shorts and T-shirt. He's going to look amazing throwing the football. I'm not worried about that. What I want to see is Quinn show that he does have that presence about him, that he is a leader, that he can be a guy you can draft to be the face of your franchise because he carries himself with that kind of swagger. I always say swagger is confidence to spare. That's what VY had. VY had confidence. He had so much confidence. It was swagger. He could sprinkle some of his confidence and swagger on you. And he's got to show that it quality, right? They're going to draft this guy to be the face of their franchise, potentially the first quarterback taken off the board. You're talking about a guy they may be drafting to go number one overall. Like, he's got that kind of ability. They want to see that it quality, that je ne sais quoi, right? That you really can't quantify it, but he's got it. I always remember the story Mac Brown told about Derrick Arroyo and Willie Nelson and George Strait. They were hanging out at the at Texas on the football field at DKR Stadium, and the there is a high school coach going on, high school coaching clinic going on. High school coach comes up to this this group, all right, of iconic men. And he asked Derrick Arroyo, hey, Derrick Arroyo, I want to be like you. Please give me advice on how to be a great coach like you. And Derrick Arroyo looks at him and says, well, if you have it, you'll make it. If you don't have it, you won't make it. And if you don't know what it is, you ain't got a chance to make it. The coach didn't know how to respond, so he just looked bewildered, stupefied, and walked off. Didn't even respond, didn't say anything. And D.K. Arroyo looked at Mac Brown, he looked at George Strait and looked at Willie Nelson and said, hell, he ain't got it. All right. You know really quickly if somebody has that it quality. It don't take long. All right. And some people got it. Some people don't. Quinn needs to show he's got that it quality today. They say a woman knows within the first 90 seconds to 3 minutes whether you are a potential mate for her. She knows. It don't take her long at all. You doing all that talking, she already got her mind made up for the most part. All right. you can only screw it up from that point on. And I think for Quinn, it's going to be something along those lines when he meets these scouts for the first time. He's got about 90 seconds to 3 minutes when he meets them for the first time, whether that be an actual face-to-face handshake conversation or whether that be just the way that they observe him. That it's going to mean a lot. Big day for Quinn Ewers, I think, in terms of the start of his evaluation for the next level.
Yeah, I mean, because it is, too. You know, they've done extensive work on everybody who's going to be at that pro day already. They've already got pages of notes, and they're going to go see if they can add anything else. But there's some of these guys that they'll walk in and maybe write two sentences about on a sheet of paper, maybe get, you know, a couple seconds of film on a phone or whatever else to get on some of these guys because they have enough. And they're not going to get anything new about it. But having Quinn in the room, seeing how he talks about his teammates, because one of the things that, you know, one of the biggest things in scouting that people don't realize is the biggest thing in scouting is talking to people to get reports on, are these guys good teammates? Are these guys people that, what are they like in the locker room? Do they fit in the systems? All those things. That's what you see. If you go, you know, the times I was spending at basketball and you'd watch scouts from around, they would go around and all they would do is go talk to the announcers, talk to the staff, talk to whoever else they could talk to get the information. And so they're going to figure out talking to Quinn, how he talks about other guys and the guise of this being, well, we want to know about Jaywin, but we really want to know about how you're going to talk about him. So we're going to get two birds with one stone going against Quinn Ewers and the throwing and everything. They'll be watching to see that, but you're right. It's about the command. It's about how he handles himself in that situation, how he makes it about other people and not himself, but can make himself the overpowering, you know, leader in the room. All those qualities is what they're going to be looking for in there. And it's hard to do, but, you know, Quinn has also been preparing for this, and Sark has been preparing Quinn for this. They know what they're doing. There's a reason why he's throwing there, because they know that this is the best way to help get him a head start in that 2025 class.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. So NFL scouts, there'll be a lot of them there too, because I would imagine some of them, first of all, they want to hang out in Austin because Austin's a cool place to visit. So they'll use it as an excuse to go to Austin. But you got spring football happening right now. Texas has a roster full of a lot of guys who have NFL futures, and they start these little dossiers of evaluation on players really early on. I wouldn't doubt if a couple of them stayed or came early to go to spring practice and check that out. And, of course, Sark would welcome those guys to come watch his team and get an early start on evaluation.
And don't forget that these guys are also coming in because there's a lot of talent at Texas, from ranging from first-round picks to undrafted free agents. You can make that trip a lot more acceptable because every team could be looking for at least one of these guys. If you only have four or five guys at your pro day, you know, you may not send as many scouts. But for this, there's from special teams all the way to starting defensive linemen, starting wide receivers, and technically with Quinn, a starting quarterback, guys that you can be trying to get a scout on for this. So you'll see a lot of scouts just because of the variety of what Texas offers at this pro day.
Yeah, it'll be – I think you'll probably get – you'll at least get more than half the teams. I think you'll get three-fourths of the teams represented at Texas Pro Day in some form or fashion, a scout, a front office exec, a coach, just in some way. I think you'll get a lot of representation from NFL teams. One cut. I think we got time to play one Sark cut here. We played, obviously, most of these cuts all day long, but this one we haven't gotten to, and it's about leadership. And I think it's important. We talked about, you know, who's going to – pick up a mantle of leadership for Texas. So cut 10, I believe it is, Patrick, please, if you wouldn't mind pulling it up. Here's Sark when being asked about, hey, how are you going to replace all the leadership you lost? Byron Murphy, you know, Jalen Ford, you lost Christian Jones, Jay Wicks, a great leader. X-Man's a great leader. JT Sanders was a great leader. Here's what Sark said about this team's specific leadership and possible leaders on the team.
You know, I think one thing, we were talking about this as a staff. I don't know necessarily if we have just one dominant voice on this team. You know, I don't know if we have Roschon Johnson as an example, but I do think we have more positive quality voices on this team. So I think our leadership is now kind of more all-encompassing, and that's what you like. You know, I'd much rather have multiple people that lead and lead in a positive way, different voices at different times, than relying on one or two voices, because when those one or two voices aren't on that day, who's leading? And I think that we're much more spread out. I feel really confident talking to different guys on our team that have been in the program that know what it looks like. You know, I generally, when we go through, you know, flex lines or stretch lines, I like to tap into those leaders and making sure our energy's right, our intent's right, what we're trying to get done for the day. I noticed it today. I was having to talk to a lot of guys, and that's a really good thing. The fact that we're returning so many offensive linemen, we are returning Quinn. I think Gunnar Helm is a guy who's been in the program, really understands. You know, Jaden Blue is a guy who's really grown up, is in year three in the program. Defensively, we talked about Alford and Vernon. You know, you look at Ethan Burke and his time here. You know, you look at David Benda, Anthony Hill already young and into his career, Michael Taff, Jahdae Barron, Jalen Gilbo. So a lot of guys, and I'm leaving some guys out, not intentionally, but it's just a different team that way. And that's the beauty. From year to year, every team is new. Every team's got to recreate their own identity and recreate their culture for that team. And so I think this year's team is a little bit different that way, that we've got a multitude of players that can lead. And as a coach, that's really comforting that I've got more guys that I can tap into and lean on.
All right, there you go. Start talking about the leadership. Interesting, some of the names he brought up. Lately, we've seen guys like Rojo, guys like Jay Witt, not frontline starters, be what I call the culture bearers of the team, where they are walking, you know, talking examples. They embody the Texas culture because they're respected by all their teammates because of their journey that they've taken, the unselfish manner in which they play and in which they practice. And some of the guys he brought up there, you know, Jalen Gilbo or Jaden Blue, guys who are veterans but are not frontline starters. But guys who may have earned the respect of their teammates by what they do behind the scenes, their unselfish nature. So I wonder, but he is making a great point about now the leadership is more widespread. It was concentrated before in pockets, in different position groups. It was concentrated. It was Rojo here. It was, you know, in that wide receiver room had a lot of leadership last season. Now he's saying, I got leaders in every position group. I got a leader in linebacker room. I got a leader on the D-line. I got a leader here. And it's not concentrated in different positions or with different players, which I think is a step in the right direction. Shows you that the torch is being passed down in different rooms. And guys are looking forward to, like I did, looking forward to the opportunity where they can lead that position group, where they can lead by example. They can lead by, you know, their conduct, lead by their habits. And you look forward to that when that's going to be you. And I remember when that was me in 2002. And I think you have a lot of guys I've talked to, Anthony Hill, who's saying that he can't wait until he's considered a leader, that he's looking forward to being that guy. And you heard Sark just mention, like, oh no, Anthony Hill's been, he's been foaming at the mouth, right? This is a guy champing at the bit to try, because he wants to be a leader on this team. And I think you got a lot of guys who are actually waiting for that opportunity. So good for them.
It's a great way that they're building the culture to understand what the loss of Bijan and Roschon meant, and having to continue to try and not have that sort of effect on the team negatively of trying to find new leaders every year. Just keep creating them, keep creating leaders at every level, sophomores, juniors, seniors. And that way you'll always have them running behind. You can keep creating them every single year, but you're creating them at a lower level to have Anthony Hills be leaders, as opposed to, you know, having to constantly rely on seniors that you know are always leaving.
Yeah, and recruit leadership, right? Recruit yeah. guys, do your research, recruit guys out of high school who have natural leadership ability, who are natural leaders,
yeah.
who relish in that role and who look forward to that. All right, good stuff there. We come back, we'll wrap it up, put it in the oven, play a little bit of Who Said That on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. It is a one artist Wednesday. That's when Patrick plays jams just from one particular artist after going through their catalog. And one artist Wednesday is all about Elvis Presley today, the king of rock and roll, as people like to call him. Coming up is our segment of Who Said That? Since we're up against it here, we got to get to it pretty quickly. So let's not waste any time. This is a college basketball coach complaining about a troubling trend in college basketball. Who said that?
There's no question about it. I would want to coach. I would want to develop my team. You've got bigger staffs than you've ever had. There's plenty of time for the portal. There's plenty of time to talk to recruits. There's plenty of time to negotiate NIL deals. There's not plenty of time to play. There's not plenty of time to get your players on the floor and give them a chance to get better. There's not plenty of time for guys to continue to play that may never get to play again. And that to me is absolutely ridiculous. It's each coach's choice. I get it. But if you take away a chance to play the games, to put your team on the floor, let them opt out. All right, the bowl season has it all the time. Let it happen. Who cares? Give your players and coaches a chance to keep coaching and playing, wow, and don't shortchange. If a guy doesn't want to play, go sit down. If a coach doesn't want to coach, go recruit. But there's got to be enough people to put 5, 6, 7 people on the floor and go play. Makes absolutely zero sense to me.
All right. That is Tom Crean talking about the troubling trend of teams declining the invitation to the NIT. Yeah. Teams, they look at it as a tournament now that is beneath them.
Yeah, there's a number of schools. Oklahoma doesn't want to be in the NIT. Memphis, Pitt, St. John's, Indiana, Ole Miss. Chris Beard said no. So there's a lot of teams that are saying, I don't want any part of that. Don't put me on that list. We're not going there. We're not part of that. We should have been in the NCAA. I agree with Tom Crean for the most part. I think it's silly if you have a young team that is developing, mm-hmm, like a lot, yeah, of these teams are, to not go in. I think if you have seniors that want to go play a couple more games, go win the NIT. I get that it's not the thing that your school is looking forward to all season. I remember when Texas won the NIT, we were all happy for Texas, and it was tongue in cheek. It wasn't the big thing, but it was good for the players. It was fun for the players. It was fun to watch the games. And I get you can say all you want about the negatives of it. That's poor leadership from the top to say we're either national champions or nothing. Because you're teaching those kids that are probably not going to be national champions at everything in the rest of their life, that nothing matters. Ricky Bobby? If you're not first, you're last.
First, you're last.
And he goes, I thought I lived my whole life by that. He goes, it's something I said when I was drunk. It's like, it's not a way to live your life. So I agree with Tom Crean that I get it, but there's reasons not to do it. For the most part, the reason I believe most coaches don't want to do it is because they don't want an NIT appearance on their resume. They'd rather have no appearance than an NIT appearance, and they don't want to put it on their resume. Now, for the players, I'm sure some don't want to be part of it. Some are going to be hurt, and if you're asking them that after the last game of the season or on Selection Sunday when they may get in, if you say, do you want to do it, they're going to knee-jerk reaction is going to be no. But at the end of the day, they probably would want to.
They want to play. Yeah, that's a good point. No, I love it. That's a great point about that. I agree with you 100% too. I think the coaches believe they got more to lose than to gain by being in the NIT, but it's supposed to be about competition. Go compete, baby.
Go compete.
It's college sports.
Why we love college sports.
Exactly. Go compete, man.
Go compete.
Maybe for some of those guys, maybe the last damn time you get to compete,
yes,
on the college level. You ain't going pro.
Play the walk-ons.
I feel you on that. Play the walk on. Play. That's a good point. Maybe start just playing the walk ons. Make it the walk on tournament, man. No doubt. All right. Thanks, my man Patrick. Doing a great job as always. Thanks to you guys out there for listening. Remember, the revolution will not be televised. We'll be talking about it right here on the Rodcast. Thanks to Charlie Wilson. Thanks to my man Nick Shuley as well. Everybody enjoy the evening. We'll be back tomorrow talking about more Texas basketball, talking more Texas spring football as well. Go to hornfm.com. Sign up for that March Madness bracket. Everybody enjoy the evening. We love you. We mean that. Peace.